I'd like to welcome members of the press and public to the 20th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2015. Can I first of all ask all those present to ensure that the electronic items are switched to flight mode so that they do not affect the work of the committee. Colleagues, can I move you to agenda item number one, which is a decision in taking business in private. The question is that we take agenda items number five and six in private. Are we all agreed? Move to agenda item number two, which is our section 23 report, NHS in Scotland 2015. Also, can I welcome Caroline Gardner, the Auditor General for Scotland, Fraser McKinlay, the Director of Performance Audit and Best Value, Tricia Meldrum, the Senior Manager, and Michael Oliphant, who is the Project Manager of Audit Scotland. I understand that Caroline Gardner has a short opening statement to make.
Good morning, Convener, and thank you. Fraser McKinlay is going to lead the briefing session this morning on my behalf, so I'll hand over to Fraser.
Thank you, Caroline. Good morning, Convener. Good morning, members. Today we have in front of you our annual overview report on the NHS in Scotland, which looks at the performance of health boards and comments on the many challenges and pressures facing the NHS. It also looks ahead to assess what progress the Scottish Government is making towards its 2020 vision of enabling everyone to live longer, healthier lives at home or in a homely setting. The National Health Service in Scotland continues to be one of our most valued public services, delivering a wide range of high-quality healthcare services to thousands of people across Scotland every day. But it will come as no surprise to the committee that the NHS is a system under significant pressure. Our report highlights tighter budgets, rising costs, increasingly demanding performance targets, and greater demands on its services. In recent years, the cost of delivering health services has increased significantly, coinciding with a period of constrained public finances. Together, these pressures signal that fundamental changes and new ways to deliver healthcare in Scotland are required now. Spending by health boards was £11.4 billion in 2014-15, which accounts for around a third of Scotland's total budget. Overall, we found that boards managed their finances well, given the scale of the pressures faced, ending the year with a very small underspend of around £10 million. However, many boards relied on one-off savings, and two boards required extra financial support from the Scottish Government to break even. Our report highlights that all territorial boards, which are those delivering the frontline services, are finding it increasingly difficult to meet performance targets and standards, with the national performance against 7 out of the 9 key targets and standards deteriorating in recent years. Ongoing financial pressures combined with greater activity and demand made achieving targets and standards more difficult. We see in the report that the number of people working in the NHS in Scotland is at its highest level. However, one of the biggest challenges facing the NHS today is the ability to attract, recruit and retain medical professionals on a permanent basis. Reasons for the difficulties include the rural location of some boards, competition between boards for specialist staff, and greater demand from staff for more flexible working arrangements. Our report highlights that boards are hiring more temporary staff to help keep services running, but this approach is increasingly expensive and provides only a short-term solution. In 2014-15, boards spent £284 million on temporary staff, an increase of 15% from the previous year. Looking ahead, Convener, we found that the Scottish Government has not made sufficient progress towards achieving its 2020 vision. There is some evidence of new approaches to delivering healthcare, although it's unlikely that all the necessary changes will be in place by 2020. The Scottish Government plans to continue working towards the vision and has launched a national conversation on the future of healthcare in Scotland. But there is a need for a clear step change in pace if these ambitions are to be realised within the timescale set. We make a number of recommendations in the report, Convener. They focus on improvements that the Scottish Government and boards should make as they continue to work towards longer-term ambitions for healthcare in Scotland. And finally, Convener, members will recall that the committee published your own report on accident and emergency in December of last year and invited the Auditor General to provide an update on A&E by the end of this year. So we have therefore also brought a briefing paper on A&E to the committee, A&E to the committee today. And this shows that performance against the A&E waiting time target deteriorated over the winter of 2014-15, but then improved over the summer. However, some NHS boards are still not meeting the target and the NHS is now moving into the more challenging winter period, although judging by the weather, I think we're probably there already. And since the Auditor General last reported, the Scottish Government has implemented a better and more structured approach to improving unscheduled care and sharing best practice. As always, Convener, the team and I are very happy to answer the committee's questions. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Auditor General, can I just open questions by firstly referring you to paragraph 50 of the report? We advise us that there's an increasing reliance on the use of the private sector to meet the performance targets. I just wonder if you could give us specific examples of how those private companies, the private sector, has been used.
Certainly. I'll ask Michael Oliphant to come in a moment, Convener. But as the report says, there are two main areas where we've seen the private sector being used. One is to ensure that waiting times targets are being met as far as possible, and the other is for specialist services that aren't otherwise available within the NHS. Michael can give you some specific examples of those.
Yeah, I think somewhat as well as the to increase the short-term capacity, it's particularly for where boards need to access to specialist treatment, and quite often that's for a small number of cases that are highly complex, or individuals that require complex care, perhaps in a higher ratio of carer to patient, and these can be for complex rehabilitation requirements, it can be for severe mental health issues, so it tends to be spend on some smaller specialist hospitals such as Huntercombe Hospital in Edinburgh or the Murdiston Brain Injury Rehabilitation Centre in Wishaw. So that's really where a lot of that spend goes.
So how specific is that? I mean, you're saying that in general terms that's the way it's been brought forward, but is there a capacity available within the NHS public sector that's not been used and this has been filled in to meet the targets?
There's an element of the private sector spend that's used for short-term capacity issues to help meet waiting times. That's whether it's private sector organisations using facilities perhaps over the weekend, or where patients are going to use private sector facilities themselves. But I think in most of the cases, it's for the specialist treatment that's required in these very complex cases that the NHS will be able to provide some element of support and care for, but where it is in increasingly complex, it's the private sector that can help out on that basis.
Okay. And just can I go back, Auditor General, because you said that the government were failing to meet the vision, the 2020 vision targets that have been set. Could you give some specific examples of that and the lack of direction of travel that you've set out?
I think it's primarily a question of pace, Convener, and I'll ask Fraser to pick up the specifics that we were basing that conclusion on.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, as you know, the 2020 vision is all about trying to get people care at home in a homely setting. And when we look at the evidence across the system, we can see some pockets of good practice in that area, but not at the kind of scale and pace that we would need to see. And in particular, trying to shift resources away from spending on acute services and hospitals and dealing with people when they walk in through the door at A&E and other places and into the community. We're just not seeing that shift big enough or fast enough, I think, is the main point.
Can I just ask, is that a political decision that's required to be taken, because you talk about decisions that have to be made, or is it a management decision of the various boards?
I mean, I think what the report tries to set out is that the government has a lot of things underway that are designed to help this, including things like the integration of health and social care. We're publishing a report tomorrow, and it's coming to the committee in a couple of weeks to give the committee an update on progress on the integration of health and social care. So both politically and managerially, they are putting things in place to help the transition and to help the shift. I think what we're seeing, though, is given the ambition of the vision that's set out for what is supposed to be achieved by 2020, that's looking very challenging. They are now looking beyond the 2020 vision. They've started the national conversation, which is about looking to the kind of 10, 15 years beyond that. I think we're expecting to see some stuff coming out of that in spring of next year. But as well as that, a national conversation in and of itself is not going to fix the issues and the pressure that we're experiencing right now.
I think, to be fair, looking very challenging to me is a bit of an understatement. I actually thought it was looking very depressing when I read this report. And if I may say, Convener, having been here since 1999, I looked at the recommendations on page 6, and these were the recommendations in 1999, 2000, when Richard Simpson and I were on the Health Committee. We were actually saying exactly the same things, and I sort of looked through the report, I boringly read the whole thing, beginning to end, and I was looking for a few gems of progress, but there was actually nothing there. So my second point is, I thought it was, I'm sorry to be on a depressing note, I don't mean to be, but Exhibit 3 on page 19, national performance against key waiting times has declined in 7 out of 9. I find that deeply, deeply worrying. And if I could go to the following page, there was one, I think the worst decline was child and adult mental health services. And if we look at the health board with the, it meets the least targets, it's NHS Grampian. And I don't think it's any coincidence that they are the poorest funded in terms of the NRAC funding formula. I think they're less than, they're further away from the funding formula. I think it's over 2% they should be paid. So, I mean, I'm just wondering, is that a direct correlation of their lack of funding in line with the funding formula, the fact that they're able to meet so few targets? But the other one that stood out to me, and still on the CAMS, Child and Adult Mental Health, was Tayside, a reduction from 79.9% meeting the target last year to 35%. And we all know that investment into mental health in children saves thousands, if not millions, in adulthood. And it's really worrying that we're missing this window of opportunity in children. So what does Audit Scotland do when something's so, I mean, there's 1 in 2% changes, and we could see that year to year, but when 79 to 35, that is really deeply, deeply distressing and worrying. What do you do with serious outliers like that? Or what should we be doing? What should NHS Tayside be doing? What should the government be doing?
And I think it's probably in that reverse order, Mrs. Scanlon. I think the board clearly is has the primary responsibility for improving performance against targets. I think it's worth saying that the overall performance around the child and adolescent mental health services number, which you'll see took a dip in last year, is due in part at least to a change and a more challenging target. We set out that that's one of the targets that's been made more that's been made tougher in terms of the time that they've to wait. So that explains some of the national change. I'll ask Michael or Tricia if they have any specifics on the Tayside number, colleagues. Do we know what happened there?
81,
yes.
Which is pretty poor, but 35 has to be very worrying.
Yeah, Michael.
Just by way of comparison, we mentioned it. Paragraph 47, where we talk about where the target became more tougher during 2014-15. So the comparable figure to the Scotland figure that you see in Exhibit 4 for the CAMS target is 88%. So it still is a decrease, but not as much as 81%.
Okay, we're talking about NHS.
I was just going to say, do we know anything about the specifics of Tayside team?
No, in this report.
We can have a look at that, Mrs. Scanlon, but I think in answer to your question about what should be done about it, as I'm sure you're aware, all the heat targets are managed very, very closely, both within boards and within Scottish Government. And when there is a dip in performance like that, we would absolutely expect a plan to be put in place to turn it around. So we'll see what we can do to find out a bit more about that.
Right, so you would be asking NHS Tayside what they're doing to address that really very worrying situation.
Yeah.
Okay. I've just got two questions, and they're ones that I've asked previous times that you've been here. Sickness absence is one that I tend to keep a bit of an eye on, and I was surprised that the highest sickness absence rate was the Scottish Ambulance Service. But they've actually been consistently high over a period. Sorry, it's paragraph 67, page 29. But this service has been higher than other services within NHS, I think apart from NHS 24, for many years now. Are there any reasons why Scottish Ambulance Service should be over 7%? Why is that such an outlier? And just if we could come back to another favourite of mine, page 39, paragraph 95, the backlog maintenance, and this committee has asked you about that quite often. There really, despite all the assurances that that was going to be addressed, it's pretty disappointing that the backlog maintenance is still £797 million. But what we're more concerned about is the significant risk, backlog maintenance with a significant risk, which is 35%, £279 million. Now, I think I'm right in saying is where you have backlog maintenance with a significant risk, it's not just a risk to staff, but my understanding is that that's also a risk to patients. So we've got about 280 million backlog maintenance with a significant risk. Could you perhaps tell me why that figure is still so high, given our assurances? And could you perhaps also define, for my memory, what significant risk means in terms of health and safety?
Thank you, Mrs. Scanlon. If I come back to the sickness absence one first, the main reason that we've cited in the report is to do with high levels of musculoskeletal complaints, which is about how the people in the ambulance service have to work the kind of unique demands that working in the ambulance service puts on people, and I think that's the reason. But as you say, that does seem to be stubbornly high, and we would expect the board to continue to look at ways of mitigating that while absolutely accepting that it's a very physically demanding job if you're a paramedic or working in ambulances. You're absolutely right, Mrs. Scanlon, and you make a really interesting point about the similarity of the recommendations that we've made over the years. And I guess on one hand, we make no apology for that. We'll keep plugging away and keep making the same points. No, I know. And I didn't take it as such, Mrs. Scanlon. I think for us, these are really, really important things. They're becoming even more important now. I think, you know, there have been some areas of progress and improvement in some places. If you look back at that, over that period of time, waiting times, for example, have got better. But more recently, we're seeing a real squeeze and all the pressures we're referring to. One of those significant pressures undoubtedly is the maintenance backlog, and it's a classic case of spinning lots of plates at once, where you're trying to invest in, as we mentioned in the report, invest in new assets, new buildings, new hospitals, to make it more fit for purpose for a 21st century health service, at the same time as dealing with increasing demand and rising costs, and needing to try and make inroads into the backlog for maintenance. I'm not absolutely sure of the significant risk point. I'll ask Michael if he can help with a definition of that, and if not, we can come back to you.
I don't have a definition to hand of the significant risk. It's something that the Scottish Government publishes as part of the Assets and Facilities Report. I think the next one will be due out early next year if the timeline is the same as previous years. You mentioned the figure of £279 million, which is considered as a significant risk. Of that, £80 million relates to properties expected to be disposed of within the next 5 years, and £65 million relates to replacements planned in the next 5 years. The Scottish Government in the report that I mentioned do have a plan in place on how to reduce this backlog over the next 5 years. The nature of backlog maintenance is that there will always be an element of backlog maintenance, and I think the focus from the Scottish Government's perspective is to try and, you know, bring it down as much as possible. And I think they're looking certainly at a five-year horizon to make some large movements in that.
Richard Simpson.
Pick up the backlog thing a little further. I mean, 96% was high risk as opposed to significant risk. But it would be interesting and useful, perhaps, if we could get figures which showed the turnover, because they'll be dealing with some of the high risk that was there, but new high risk will be coming in, and your report actually doesn't make that clear. And given there's a 57% reduction in capital between 2008-09 and 2014-15, the consequences of that, in terms of the maintenance backlog, is again something I'm quite surprised you didn't comment on, because if we're not investing in new structures sufficiently with such a massive reduction in capital, which I know is as a result partly of the UK government's reduction, but also transfer into revenue, that's going to have consequences. I just thought it might be useful to get a slightly fuller report on the inputs, outputs, and the consequences of the capital risk. I don't know if you want to make any comments just now or come back to us on that.
Happy to just comment briefly, Mr. Simon. I think that's a very good question. So I suppose every year when we do the overview report on the NHS, we are always looking for things that we might want to drill into a bit further for future work on behalf of the Auditor General. So we can absolutely look at maintenance and the estate, managing the estate as part of that programme development activity that we do. So I'm very happy to take that on board.
Because if we can also divide out the unused buildings, because they're unused, sure. They may have some public safety issues, but they're not really, even if they're a high risk within the building, it's not affecting the clinical care. And the thing I'm really interested in is the fit for purpose part of the estate, which is in your report, which is not very high. I think it's about 65% is the percentage that's fit for use. But if I can turn to the main thing, which is this, we have this debate about the health budget and whether it's increasing or decreasing. And of course, both figures are in your report, the 0.7 reduction in real overall terms in health spend in Scotland between 2008-09, 2014-15. That's the overall reduction, capital and revenue, with an increase in revenue and a decrease in capital. But what I wonder is how that 2.2% increase in revenue relates not to real terms, which is what you've given us, but to the fact that the NHS deflator is always different and always higher. Now, that does vary a bit because, for example, I know pharmaceuticals have been not increasing by the amount that had been previously expected, but on the other hand, recently there have been big increases. Trying to get a handle on that NHS deflator, you haven't commented on that at all. And I know it's difficult, but historically we should at least have some indication figure, I would have thought, from you as to what the NHS deflator has been over this period of time, because the statement of a headline reduction in real terms is already obviously a very big political issue as well as a concern to the public that health spending in Scotland has gone down in real terms. But getting that division, can you give us a further comment on that in relation to NHS deflator?
I'll ask Michael to come in on some of the specifics, Mr. Simpson, but I guess I'm always struck that how the answer to a simple question like is the money going up or down can be a very complicated answer, and you've just explained that extremely clearly. I think we do say in the report that costs are increasing. We've reported in the past about some of this very specific nature of inflation in the health service. I guess from where we're coming from, it's important, and again we'll take that feedback on board for future reports, but it's important for us to use numbers that are absolutely reliable and robust and understandable that everyone can kind of sign up to and recognise. And as you say, coming to a figure for NHS inflation is quite a tricky thing. Having said that, I'll ask Michael if he can help with any specifics.
Just to add to that, certainly the healthcare inflation, I think historically is a bit more volatile than perhaps the GDP deflator would be, but as Fraser alludes to, the GDP deflator is probably better recognised in terms of looking at the overall budget figures. I think the other point I would just make is that the health budget is largely relates to staff costs, which would fall in line more with the GDP deflator than perhaps the healthcare indexes would show. One of the key components as to why specific healthcare inflation might be more variable is drugs costs. And I think we mentioned in paragraph 27, the first bullet point, that looking ahead, boards are planning for average cost increases in primary and secondary care drugs of 5 and 16% respectively, which, looking at a drugs budget of about 1.4 billion, it's still a decent chunk of the overall NHS budget, but it's not necessarily, you wouldn't be able to apply these rates to the whole budget.
I understand. I mean, the hepatitis C costs are really one of the major factors, I think, in the pharmaceutical. Can I just turn to workforce, convener, just briefly? I'm really quite impressed by the agency versus bank staff costs, that agency costs at 42.97 pence per hour are three times the level of bank staff. But if you look at the very helpful exhibits that you've given us on that, the bank staff clearly do, numbers of bank staff don't rise, and yet the numbers in the agency staff do. So and the highest cost I think was £57 in Dumfries and Galloway. Do you think, from a financial perspective, there are the potential for actually putting a national cap on, as they've done in England? Would that work? And the second thing is really, what should the boards be doing to actually try and convert some of these agency staff into bank staff, which would produce some considerable savings? Because I think the increase in number of agency staff and midwifery staff increased by 53% in agency nursing staff increased by 53% in 2014-15, and with the vacancy rates running at the levels they are, which has again been deteriorating every year since 2011, and an accelerating rate in deterioration of in vacancy. I mean, the increase in vacancies is accelerating, not decelerating. This is an area that really concerns me. So are there any suggestions you can make as to how the board should be addressing this issue, or how the government should nationally be addressing this issue, other than the national locum provision, which I think you've got as one of your recommendations?
And it concerns us too, Mr. Simpson, which is why this year we've focused quite heavily on the workforce issues, because we've recognised the last couple of years that it is an increasing pressure. It is, as Michael said a minute ago, a people business in lots of ways, the NHS. First of all, not for us to say whether a cap's a good thing or a bad thing. I think that's a policy decision rightly for government. I guess what I would say is, before you get into a conversation about caps, there's a lot that could be done. And I think you've just mentioned some of those things. And in particular, being able to convert some of the agency staff into bank staff would actually save quite a lot of money and would be a good place to start. Agencies are used, I think, to plug some short-term gaps, and you need to do that sometimes, but shifting the balance I think would be important. We make the recommendation in the report about the need for a more coordinated and national approach. I think one of the things that struck us looking at the plans in more detail is, given that it is a national service delivering, broadly speaking, the same services across the country, we might have expected more by way of national coordinated workforce planning, and that's why we have the recommendation in there, and we'll be very interested to see what the government's response is to that.
Yes, I mean, they do have the new workforce plan, but it's, I don't want to be too critical, but it does seem fairly nebulous. It's all very aspirational and there isn't much detail. I mean, revitalising the bank system and having actually better retainers for the bank system and support in training, which, a bit of which is done already, but actually treating it as an auxiliary workforce rather than the traditional bank that I certainly used to be involved in might do it. I'd like to come back later, but I think I've had my say for the moment.
Combi.
Thank you. I'm looking at Exhibit 3 on page 19, and I'm looking at delayed discharges, which have been an issue that's exercised this committee in the past. And I'm looking at, obviously, the progression from 2012 to 2015, which looks like a fairly dramatic deterioration. However, I am looking also that the target has become very challenging. It's gone from 42 days to 28 days to 14 days. Looking at this, is there actually a deterioration in the patient experience, as the headline figure would seem to indicate, or is it actually simply the target has become more challenging and more difficult to meet?
It's difficult for us to know whether the patient experience has deteriorated. I think the patient survey that we actually mention it in the A&E report, Mr. Beattie, would suggest that overall patient satisfaction and patient experience is improving slightly. But as you say, the target around delayed discharges, because people recognise that it's a major problem for individuals and for the system, has been toughened up significantly. So as you say, that is partly why the performance is as you see it. I think it is also worth pointing out, and Michael will help me with the exact reference here, is that we also say in the report that the number of people experiencing very long waits has also been increasing. I think that can't be a good thing. So it's difficult for me to say definitely it's one thing or the other, but there's no doubt that it's no coincidence that the delayed discharges is one of the two targets that have been significantly hardened up in recent years.
Continuing on the delayed discharge, obviously delayed discharges arise from a variety of reasons. To what extent is it the impact of partners that are causing delayed discharge?
Again, difficult to be specific about that, but I think what is absolutely clear about delayed discharges is it's a systemic issue. It's not just about the hospital, it's not just about the social work, it's about all of that working together. And as I mentioned earlier, the integration of health and social care is in part designed to help with just that. The Scottish Government has been investing in reducing delayed discharges. We think there are some examples of good practice that can be shared and shared more widely and more quickly. But it is, you're absolutely right, this is not a thing that one bit of the system can fix on their own. It needs everyone to be working together to improve it.
Okay. Looking at paragraph 40 on the page before, it says here that inpatient cases have increased by 13% between 2010 and 2015. To what extent has that impacted on actual bed nights in terms of stays in hospital? In other words, has it impacted on the any strain on the available beds? And would it have any knock-on effect into the delayed discharges?
Michael, can we help with
that? Don't have any specific analysis that would back that up, but it certainly, you know, we're flagging up as another pressure within the system, that the fact that as well as having demanding targets, there's also the rise in activity as well as demand for healthcare. And the inpatient cases that you mentioned and outpatient appointments are both examples of where we're seeing increased demand for healthcare, so it just adds to the pressure of the system.
I mean, clearly, an increase in inpatient cases are going to impact on overnight stays or times in hospitals, beds available, and potentially delayed discharges as well.
Some detailed modelling at the moment for a report that's due for publication in 2016 around changing models of health and social care, which I think will shine some light on both your questions there, Mr. Beattie. It is a complex system, and actually there are trends pulling in very different directions. So for adults with acute needs, lengths of stay are still continuing to shorten, increasing levels of day surgery as well. For older people, there's a group of people who, once they've been admitted, are very difficult to discharge safely. And the question is not just so social care to get them home properly, but health and social care services to avoid the need for that admission in the first place where it's possible. So it's a really complex thing, and I hope the work we're preparing at the moment will just give a bit more insight into what's happening there.
Okay. Just turning to some of the comments that have been made throughout the report, there's repetition of the word greater flexibility in managing finances. What do you mean by greater flexibility?
Again, something we've reported on regularly in this report, Mr. Beattie, is in a sense, the way it's, I've heard it described, is meeting the financial targets at the year end is a little bit like landing a jumbo jet on a penny piece. It's a very difficult thing to pull off, and as we explain, there's quite a lot of movement in year, there's quite a lot of things happen towards the year end to try and balance the books. I think what we're saying in terms of flexibility is if boards didn't have to do that every year, they could take a longer-term perspective on investment, on where to invest in different services or redesigning how healthcare is delivered, and give them a little bit more room for manoeuvre, a little bit more freedom to plan into the longer term. We have a section in the report which talks about new powers coming to the Scottish Parliament and ultimately to Scottish Government, and as well as the potential to raise more taxes, that also maybe gives a bit of flexibility to use existing money more flexibly for the health service. The Auditor General has recommended that now for a number of years. We're still very keen. This government has made some moves to that end, so boards are able now to keep surpluses that they might make in the year. We think there's more to do there, and it's critical if they are, in a sense, trying to ride both horses of keeping the service running day to day, but also investing in redesigning services for the future. We think something needs to be freed up there.
And just one last question on paragraph 25 on page 15. You refer to non-recurring expenses, non-recurring savings. You say 25% of board savings in 14-15 were non-recurring, and obviously that's a concern as to sustainability. Are you satisfied that the boards are addressing that? Are you satisfied that they're aware of the need for recurring savings, for the non-recurring savings to be replaced by recurring savings?
I think they're aware of it. I think they're finding it very difficult to do, would be my short answer. Michael, anything to add to that?
I think that's it. I think quite often, looking at the LDP financial plans and some of the projections around recurring and non-recurring, the balance, it probably looks a lot more favourable in terms of recurring. But as the financial years get closer, you see the non-recurring element increasing to more than what they anticipated. There's variability between the boards, as you would expect, but certainly it's a key pressure that I think boards ultimately would like to address that balance more in favour of the recurring. It's better for the longer term financial sustainability of the board.
Looking at the headline figure here, obviously it doesn't look like over the last 2 or 3 years there's been a great deal of progress in that. Do you find that there is an underlying trend? I mean, obviously you're very much looking at trend analysis and everything here. Is there an underlying trend to improve that?
So again, I'll ask Michael to come in there.
I think in terms of the trend, it's just sort of, as we said, you know, the pressure has been there and continues to be so, and it'll just be with the, obviously the non-recurring savings, they can only be made once. And that's the key thing. There'll be a limit to what to the extent that non-recurring savings can be used as boards maybe look to sell assets and so on. So I think boards have used them quite a bit over the last few financial years. It'll be even more challenging as we go ahead, you know, that for them to find these non-recurring savings. So there'll be more pressure on boards to find recurring savings to ensure that they meet their savings targets.
We do say in the report, Mr. Beattie, that the 25% is 4% and 3% higher than the last couple of years. Now, I know that's not going very far back, but that might signal at least the beginning of a trend, and you'll be considering some reports later from the Auditor General on specific boards where this is very much part of the story there. And I think while we're not at all saying that one-off savings are a bad thing, because obviously if you can sell a surplus asset or a surplus building and get a capital receipt for that, that's a good thing. Our concern is the extent to which boards are relying on that to break even. And as I say, there's at least one report later on the agenda where that's been the case.
Could I just start with a plea, please, and I go back to Exhibit 3 and the data on delayed discharges. I understand that you're reporting against targets that are moving, but could I just make the plea that to me that those numbers turn out to be meaningless because the target has moved. Is there any possibility that you could generate data which sticks to the same target over a period, so there's comparative long-term figures, even if it's not the government's target at the time? I'm asking that as a question because I recognise they may report against their target and not against the old target, and the answer might be no, you can't, but sitting here it doesn't help. Could I then turn on, please, can I just pick up... Yeah, go on, please do.
It's an important point. The underlying data is available, and we can certainly show you what's actually happening across Scotland and by Health Board against the targets. The broader point we're making in the report, though, is that the system as a whole is under pressure for reasons we all understand. And we do have a concern that it's not clear what the effect is of tightening targets like the one on delayed discharge and the one on A&E performance, that adds to the pressure on the acute system, and the knock-on effects into the wider community system are important and much less visible. And that's one of the reasons why we reported in the way that we have.
That's a very fair point. Thank you very much for that. Could I just go back, Convener, to the point that Michael Oliphant was talking about earlier about private sector use? Because you commented on why it occurred. I'm just wondering, could you give me some thoughts as to whether or not what you saw seemed to be reasonable and appropriate? Because clearly most boards will not have very specialist facilities. Did this seem to be a reasonable use of the facilities and the resources?
I hope you don't think I'm ducking the question, Mr. Don, but I think that might be not really for us. And I say that because a lot of these will be clinical decisions, and so not really for us to comment on its reasonableness. I guess the other thing I would observe is that it is a very, very small amount of money in proportionate terms in terms of the overall budget. I mean, it's still you know, still a significant chunk, and it has increased. And I certainly think it's, as Michael said, the fact that some private services are being used to manage the capacity issues and the pressures in terms of waiting times is one thing. But as Michael explained earlier, some of that is about a clinical decision about where treatment is best, and it's not really for us to make a judgment on that, I think.
Right, thank you. I think that the fact that you're not saying it's inappropriate is actually probably all I need to hear. Thank you. I'm just wondering if I could go, though, to the very long-term affordability, because I've heard you commenting on the problem of landing a jumbo deck on a very small space and the end-of-year financial planning, which is plainly ludicrous and has been for every large organisation and any annual plan. You've spoken about the need to get over the year end, and, of course, we do plans on a 2 or 3 year basis, maybe 5 if we're lucky. Am I right in thinking that maybe with the benefit of your long experience of this, even that's not sensible, and that the changes which we need to make to the NHS need to be planned over 10, 20 years, and boards sometimes need to be able to do that? If we give them carte blanche, undoubtedly everything will be pushed back forever and they've all retired, and one doesn't need to be cynical to see where that might go. But sometimes surely it will be appropriate to have a 10-year financial plan. For a very big hospital, that would surely be the case anyway.
So yes, I think we would agree with that. And while it is, I think it would be beneficial to have more flexibility at the year end, nor do we think that's a reason for boards not trying to plan into the longer term. And we have a recommendation in the report that says they need to look beyond the 3 to 5 year horizon, which many boards now do, into the 5 to 10, and possibly even beyond that demographic. We understand quite a lot now about demographic pressures and how that's going to change. And of course, that involves making all sorts of assumptions. But I think, as we say in the report, boards should be able to plan for a best, worst, most likely case scenario. And we would absolutely encourage them to do that.
OK, last one, if I might, convener. I'll just come back to the workforce planning issue. You mentioned in paragraph 56, and probably other places as well, about the demographics of the workforce and the length of time that it takes to train a doctor. Should we not simply be planning around those who are available?
Sorry, Mr. Don, I'm not sure I understand the question.
Well, rather than trying to run the NHS, or I assume somebody's trying to plan the NHS around the services they think they want to deliver. And I'm just wondering whether it should be planned around the services which might actually be deliverable, given the staff you will have available.
So, if I'm understanding the question correctly, I think you need to do both. I think this is the challenge I described as kind of riding the two horses earlier. I mean, I think because of the changing demographic and because of what the vision for 2020 says, and as I say, we'll see what the national conversation brings out, the kind of care, the kind of healthcare that's required in 20, 30 years is probably not the same that's required today. So as well as managing the system just now, and dealing with the pressures we're currently facing, they also need to be redesigning services that will be more fit for the world in 15, 20 years' time. And that has to include the kind of people that the NHS employs, the balance of those people, the kind of skills they have. So I think they also need to be looking to the future as well as managing the day-to-day.
Okay. Stuart McMillan, he'll be followed by Tavish Scott. So, right here.
thank you. Just on the question of the backlog maintenance, I didn't see any information here regarding the ESA 10 situation in terms of new buildings. How much of that actually had an effect upon the capital situation and the backlog maintenance, please?
As far as we're aware, certainly for the projects that we mentioned in Exhibit 10B, the Dumfries and Galloway Hospital and the Royal Hospital for Sick Children, these are parts of the ongoing discussions that I think the Scottish Government are having with Treasury. At the moment, you know, they're planned as NPD projects, the non-profit distribution method. And as far as we understand, the talks are still ongoing, so there's been no decision around their status.
Okay. Nigel kind of touched upon the delayed discharge. I was going to ask a question regarding the comparison. But on the workforce planning, obviously, and I don't disagree with the comments in the report regarding working to decrease the costs for the agency, the costs to the NHS. But in terms of the major events that take place in the country, such as like last year when we had the Commonwealth Games, now that wasn't just about building new infrastructure to host the Games. There was a huge amount of workforce planning throughout the public sector will have taken place for that, and also cost for that. How much of that additional cost will have been factored into this report?
So Michael will keep me right on this, but I don't think specifically we've picked out those kinds of events. We did, when we reported on the Commonwealth Games, we did look at the additional costs, and as it happens, as luck would have it, Michael did that report as well, so he'll be able to tell you more. But from memory, that report said that the we didn't identify many significant additional costs to other public sector partners as a result of the Games, was what we said there, albeit we might have expected to, but that wasn't what we found. And I guess in any year there might be maybe not something as significant in the Commonwealth Games, but stuff will happen. And therefore, I think we are looking at, again, the trend, the longer term, to identify what is a trend in the use of agency staff that really could be managed, I think.
And just on the agency staff, I would imagine that people might want to join an agency for a whole variety of reasons, as compared to becoming a direct NHS Scotland employee. And I'd imagine one of those reasons would be potential about the flexibility because of their own individual life circumstances. And so with that being the case, well, being one of the potential examples, then I would think that it would be very difficult for anybody who's running the NHS in Scotland to really attempt to manage that particular issue effectively or well at all, because if someone wants to join an agency as compared to becoming a direct employee, then how can you actually manage that? How can NHS Scotland actually manage that very effectively?
So there's no doubt, Mr. McMillan, that people will have all sorts of reasons for choosing how and where they work. I suppose our starting point is the Exhibit 8, which shows it's going up, and the very significant cost difference. You know, an average £42.97, very specifically, for agency staff in 1562. So we're not suggesting that you necessarily get to a position where there are no agency staff at all. But shifting that balance has to be something that is going to save some money and has to be a good thing. And I guess that's our challenge. We're not suggesting it's easy. We're not suggesting that any of this, the NHS as a system, is not an easy thing to manage. But it does seem to me that those cost differences are really quite significant, and so more needs to be done to try and shift the balance.
Well, certainly, I will reiterate the point that I don't disagree with the points that are in the report regarding working to reduce.
Sure.
But I do recognise that with individuals and with their own set of circumstances, for their family circumstances, then it is an extremely challenging thing to really work towards to try to address.
Davy Scott.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Firstly, just all these mentions of jumbo jets, I'm really grateful you're the National Auditor, Mr. McKinlay, not the pilot that will take me home this weekend. But can I ask a couple of questions? The first one follows on from Mary Scanlon's point about mental health services. I was told at a meeting of parents dealing with this in terms of their family in Lerwick on Monday night that NHS Shetland is discharging people to avoid their heat target. Did you come across any evidence of that when this work was being undertaken?
Not specifically, Mr. Scott. No, we haven't. The nature of this work tends to be, because it's the national overview, we tend to use nationally available data on the accounts and those kinds of things. So we would tend not to get into the detail of that.
Part of interest.
Pardon?
Where would that appear, if anywhere?
Well, I mean, if people have concerns about how waiting times are being managed, then they would blow the whistle, I think. There is a confidential...
It's just an audit issue about being accurate about what's actually going on, and I genuinely don't know how we tackle that or find out the reality of it. You know, I hear an anecdotal story, and I found 8 cases that I can point to, but I'd be worried if that was a message right across Scotland.
Sure, as as would we. I mean, I think it's important that the people that have the concerns are raising it through the appropriate channels,
Yeah, okay. Can I take you to 72, paragraph 72, which Richard Simpson rightly raised earlier on, and indeed Stuart McWilliams just mentioned it as well. And the two things that strike me, firstly, there's a specific rural issue that you've mentioned, island boards and rural issues about both locum costs and agency costs and bank costs, all of which are going the wrong way. The numbers are even worse in rural parts of Scotland. And then you just answered Nigel Don's question about a 5 to 10 year horizon. You know, there doesn't seem to me to be any real focus on the specific problems that are clearly very costly to the NHS in terms of rural and island boards. Have you pushed that at the government or pushed that at the NHS at the more senior level to say, right, in workforce planning terms, there's a specific problem here. What's being done about it?
I mean, I think the government and boards are, and particularly the boards that are dealing with the pressures in the islands and remote and rural communities, are absolutely aware of that, and they are absolutely trying to do things to manage it. I think we mentioned in the report some innovative things that some boards are doing to try and attract and recruit people. But as we mentioned in the report as well, then, you know, quite often boards are in competition for the same kinds of people. So I think the point that we make in the report, which is why the recommendation is directed at Scottish Government about national workforce planning, is that this is not a thing that the boards can fix in isolation of each other. That there are things that they can and should do, for sure, but it does need a national and coordinated approach, which is why we think more can be done around national workforce planning to make it more targeted, to make it more focused, both to deal with some of those immediate pressures, but doing so in a way that has an eye to what healthcare is going to look like in 10 years' time.
Sure. So paragraph 77 says boards do not give an overview of national workforce issues or trends. They do not provide solutions across boards or nationally to problems such as difficulties in recruiting and retaining staff. Well, that's fundamental, isn't it? If those things are not happening, and I don't know if you mean they haven't happened during the time span of this particular Audit Scotland report or whether this is a long-term issue, I tend to agree with Mary. I think we've been at this for 15 years as well. Then that's a pretty fundamental finding in paragraph 77 about what's not working.
And we go on in 78 and 79 to give a bit more detail on what the government has done and why we think that's limited and why we think more needs to be done on a national level. The six priority actions for 15-16 that we mentioned at the top of page 33 are fine, they're good, and we think it needs to go further because of that sense of it still being a bit too focused on individual boards and what they can do rather than taking a nationally coordinated approach.
Thank you. But none of those 6 points have the particular point about rural and island boards who are facing the highest costs. Would it be legitimate, fair to say, given those costs and those problems that you rightly say boards are totally aware of, and I know they are, that should be another, dare I say it, bullet point? They need to specifically recognise that.
I mean, the issue needs to be specifically recognised somewhere, whether it's in those bullet points or not is for someone else to decide, Mr Scott. But yeah, for sure, there are and there are very particular issues in rural areas, and there are particular pressures in other parts of the system too.
Okay, many thanks.
Question from Richard Simpson.
One question, a couple of comments. One is at the health committee, when we were looking at finance and getting the finance directors in front of us, we were trying to drill down into the costs of having 100% guarantee as opposed to 90 to 95% guarantee. And certainly they and Paul Gray admitted that having a 100% legal guarantee, which we're failing on for 10,000 Scots a year. So we're not even successfully doing it, but the struggle to make that has massive marginal costs. And again, I'm somewhat surprised that the report of the overview is very good on the bank and agency staff, and that area ensures the costs, but you haven't commented on the marginal costs as far as I can see. I've maybe missed it because we do have a lot of paper to read, but the finance directors weren't either able or prepared to give us that information, and yet the constant struggle to do that. We know anecdotally about locum costs of £3,000 for one session was in the press recently. These are massive costs, and Mr. Oliphant referred to the private sector and leaving aside Hunterston and the brain injury units, which are actually appropriate use, I think, of third sector or private organisations, the overspill used for private, you know, to do bunions and other operations where there's no real clinical urgency, but to meet a target. I mean, the cost of this, I really would like to know, or to have some idea of it. Is there any way that you can give us that, or could in future give us that, or require the boards to do that? Because it must be, they must know.
So I'll ask Michael in a sec to comment on the specifics of whether we can and give it, figure out that cost, the additional cost that's involved in meeting those targets. I think what we have said in this report, and certainly in previous reports, is we absolutely recognise that there is a disproportionate effect on focusing on delivering the last few percentage points of a target. And that is one of the things that is making it more difficult for the system to redesign how it delivers healthcare. And we said that in 13-14. We make the point in here about more challenging targets more generally. So again, your point is very fair, Mr. Simpson, about the extent to which we've gone into the specifics of that in this report. Michael?
In terms of finding out that cost or the marginal cost, as you describe it, it would be very difficult in a way that it's actually quite difficult to look at the cost of one target in isolation and the cost to the NHS of them meeting, say, a delayed discharges target, because all the targets are can be very much interlinked and be very difficult to separate that out to get a very accurate figure. There might be some analysis that can be done to provide an indication, and certainly we would need to explore that with boards to get a sense of the data and the costs that they might be using. And just to sort of mention, that as Fraser alluded to in paragraph 51, we do draw out the point that the Scottish Government and boards place an extensive effort in meeting these targets, but we do flag up that you know, that there needs to be the balance between focusing on the short-term targets, but also this longer-term transformational change that's required for the NHS, and it's important that the right balance is struck.
I may be being very simple about this. Yeah, but if you're spending the money trying to reach that last 1 or 2% of a target, you're not going to be able to have the money for transformational change. Can I just ask if we can get an update at some point on daycare? A very good report that you did on daycare, huge variation between boards. I don't know if you're intending to do an update on that. And maybe I could write with other questions to Ms. Gardner.
Thank you, Vina. If I could just follow up the point about the marginal cost, which of course is crucial to any economic model of anything. I appreciate that as auditors you go looking for the data that's already out there and you try and analyse it. Could I just ask if the marginal costings within the NHS are not available, whether somebody should be asking for some research so that it is? Because it is surely absolutely crucial to the economic model.
I'll step in and perhaps echo the frustrations that Ms. Scanlon and Dr. Simpson have expressed already today, that it feels as though for as long as I've been involved in public audit in Scotland, we've been talking about poor cost information about the NHS. Michael's absolutely right. Over and above the amount which is spent with private sector providers to meet waiting times targets, it's very hard to come up with a cost of what of the total cost of the NHS is contributing towards waiting times and other priorities. And I think having that better data is fundamental to be able to make the sorts of shifts that we know are needed and that are not keeping up with the pace of both the financial pressures and the demographic and other demands on the system.
Ellen?
Yes, various colleagues have mentioned the workforce and vacancies. I'm quite worried at the figure for consultants, nursing and midwife vacancies. There's been an 87% increase of vacancies for 6 months or more, page 26, exhibit 6, an 87% increase over the last year. But when you drill down to that paragraph 58, what worries me about this report is we're looking at the referral for cancer treatment, you know, the 31 or the 62 days. But in actual fact, I'm not, if it was me, and hopefully it won't be, but I think most patients, they're not so much worried about the first doctor that they see, is will my treatment lead to a good outcome and a good survival? And what I would worry about looking at this report, and I apologise for going back, but for as long as I can remember, there's been shortages in clinical radiology. That's been over 10 years, and it's still 12% of the posts are vacant in radiology. So what I'm worried about is the actual targets are pretty meaningless. The first time you see a doctor, well, that's fine. But what I would be worried about is, will I get my treatment on time? And will it treat my cancer? Will I have a good outcome? And what I'm wondering about is, can we in future look at the impact of the vacancies on survival? Because we're not looking at that, because my information is a bit out of date, but I think I'm right in saying that the survival rates in Scotland are quite poor compared with the rest of Europe. And I wonder how much the vacancy rates, general acute medicine, 17% vacancies, radiology, 12%. And I just wonder, in future, can we look at something rather than the fairly meaningless targets and look at what is the outcome? Because that's not what we're seeing. And I think, I know I'm only here for another 4 months, but I wonder, Auditor General, if that's something you could look at for future. I think we need more stark figures about our survival. And I think that might, we've had over 10 years to work with universities to get more radiologists. It's still as bad as it ever was. And so people going for cancer treatment, if they knew that there's 40 vacancies, that's very worrying.
It's a very timely question. We're just in the process now, as a team, of planning what we want to include in this report for next year. It's like the fourth road bridge. We're constantly starting on the next version. I absolutely take the point about there being scope for more outcomes in here. Equally, I think it is important, and particularly for this committee, to keep that clear focus on inputs, on the money and the other things that deliver services. But we'll look at how we can deliver that in ways that are meaningful, because they're quite complex relationships, as you can imagine.
Okay. Before we move to agenda item number 3, can I just suspend the meeting just for 5 minutes, just to allow for the changeover of the witnesses and comfort break? agenda item number three. We have three Section 22 reports. We have the 2014-15 audit of NHS 24. We have the 2014-15 audit of NHS Tayside and the 2014-15 audit of NHS Highland. We propose to take these in turn and receive an opening statement firstly, and then an opportunity for members to question on each statement individually. So I understand that the Auditor General has a brief opening statement to make in respect of NHS 24.
Thank you, Convener. Again, Fraser will lead on my behalf in terms of briefing the committee, and Nick at the end of the row here is the appointed auditor for NHS 24, on whose annual audit report my report is based, and he'll help us to answer any questions the committee may have.
Thank you, Karen. Thank you, Convener. First of all, just about very briefly about all three, it's worth highlighting that the external auditors of the three boards have given an unqualified opinion on the 2014-15 accounts, which means that they're satisfied that the accounts provide a true and fair view and there are no significant errors in the accounts. But we've prepared these reports because we believe there are issues of significant public interest that have been highlighted in the auditors' reports to the Auditor General, and the Auditor General felt it important to bring those to the attention of Parliament and the public through this committee. So turning to NHS 24, first of all, Convener, the committee, I'm sure, will be well aware of the issues arising from the implementation of a new IT system in NHS 24. The Auditor General did report under Section 22 last year to the committee last October on some of the issues in NHS 24, but due to legal action that was underway at that time with one of the external IT suppliers, which is Capgemini, it was fairly brief. Now that mediation process, the legal process, has been withdrawn, we are now in a position to give you a fuller update. NHS 24 started work on the Futures Programme back in 2009. It was originally due to go live in June 2013, but then subsequently it was delayed to October and then postponed due to the new system's failure to meet critical patient safety performance measures. Since then, through the legal process and then subsequently, NHS 24 has worked with both suppliers involved, Capgemini and BT, to develop the system and try and resolve the patient handling performance issues. The board agreed at its February 2015 meeting to a two-phase approach to implementation, the first phase of which was implemented on schedule in October of this year. But I'm sure, as the committee will be well aware, and certainly since we laid the Section 22 report in Parliament, the board has subsequently decided that because of concerns over the performance of the system and patient safety, they have now decided to delay the implementation until 2016, particularly to ensure patient safety over the winter period. Clearly, costs have increased significantly, Convener. The total cost of the programme has risen by 55% to £117.4 million, compared to an outline business case cost of £75.8 million. This cost covers the 10-year contract period, and the increases are due to changes in the contract specification and costs associated with the delays. There continue to be significant costs incurred by the board in running the existing systems. Each month, the programme is not the Futures programme is not operational. NHS 24 is incurring around £450,000 in additional cost. And clearly, if implementation is not successful, double running costs will increase still further during 15-16. And very finally, Convener, NHS 24 have included the cost of implementing the Future programme in their financial plans. However, given the scale of the challenge, the auditor's view is that delivering the financial targets will be really very difficult and will largely depend on achieving some significant efficiency savings in year. We would be delighted to answer any questions you have on the report, Convener. Thank you.
Can I just open questions in respect of the paragraph where you refer to contract management and paragraph 15? And looking ahead, I think one of the challenges that we always face in looking at these reports is there anything that could have been forecasted? So could you have foreseen there would be some of these challenges? A very similar contribution from what Mary Scanlon referred to here. I mean, we've been referring to IT reports in this Parliament since it was formed in 1999. And the issue in respect of lack of specialist knowledge comes up in every single report. So surely those who are planning the requirement of the IT system should have been able to recognise that they just don't have the specialist knowledge, and they would have to go through the appropriate recruitment procedure so that they won't have to rely on the private contractor. So, if this was a company running this, they would be bankrupt. They wouldn't have public money to keep pumping into it. So, is there an issue here concerning those who are managing this project?
And we absolutely recognise and share that frustration, Convener. We had the ICT report here just quite recently, and you took evidence from those in the Scottish Government. And I think you've got the head of digital, the Chief Information Officer, coming next week as part of your panel. And it is enormously frustrating that we continue to see the same mistakes being repeated. For our part, I was having a conversation with my team yesterday about whether there's anything more or different we could do as auditors, because, as you say, we have been saying the same things a number of times. But I would also say that the responsibility for this lies with the people planning and managing the projects. It is surprising that at the outset of such a significant IT programme, some of those lessons weren't learned at the outset. I think, as you say, we see lots of the same issues here to do with experience, to do with optimism bias, to do with a whole bunch of stuff that we see repeated over and over again. So it is really disappointing and problematic that they're having to spend such a lot of public money on trying to get this thing fixed. When we reported at the time, at that point, it looked like it was going to be delivered. Of course, now we know it hasn't. So I think the other thing to say to the committee is, obviously, Nick and his team, with my team in Audit Scotland, will continue to keep a very close watch on what happens with the new system. Our expectation is that, well, I think they're doing some specific review work at the moment. We would expect to see that reported soon. We'll look to see what the detailed plans are for implementing the system. Clearly, the Auditor General has the option to report back to the committee in future.
Move on. In terms of who would be responsible, so I think the issue for me here is having a clear pathway to who is responsible for the way in which these contracts are prepared, who would be responsible for recruitment. Effectively, would that be the chief executive? Would it be the digital team, as we're referring to now? I mean, who are the individuals, or who is the individual who would be responsible?
So, ultimately, in NHS 24's context, the accountable officer is the accountable officer for everything that happens in that board. That's where I would start. Clearly, then, there is a question about the way in which these significant public sector IT projects are supported by the wider environment. And I think that's where the Scottish Government and the digital team come in. In the NHS terms, we have National Services Scotland, who have a big procurement function and are experienced in IT. So there is a wider system question about how we're bringing to bear that experience that's in the system on big contracts like this, Convener.
Do you accept the point I made in respect of this as a private company, they'd be bankrupt? I mean, you can't keep pumping public money into something that's clearly not working. And that's what's happening here, is that there's public money, so let's just prop it up. And that's what's going on here, isn't it?
I might ask Nick to come in and offer a view. I mean, I think it's a specific answer to the question. I suppose it depends on the private company. So some private companies might have gone bankrupt. Some bigger private companies may also have had to throw money at the problem. I don't think it's necessarily the case that the private sector always get this stuff right too. But I don't know if Nick has any perspective on that.
Well, I would say, Convener, that NHS 24 is a relatively small special health board compared with some of the other health boards, and a project that takes forecast 117.4 million is considerably above its annual expenditures.
Okay, Mary Scanlon.
Well, it's just 2 points, and trying to understand this. My page here. Paragraph 7. It subsequently became apparent there were flaws with the contract documentation, including the performance measures specified in the tender negotiation documents not appearing in the final contract. So who draws up the contract documentation, I'm trying to... Whose fault is it? You know, was it NHS at fault? Did they not clearly specify what they wanted? Or are Capgemini at fault by not meeting the specifications that were in the contract? I didn't really quite understand this. There were flaws with the contract documentation. I wonder if you could clarify that.
Again, I'll ask Nick to come in a second, Mrs. Scanlon. I mean, basically, I think what happened here is that there was a gap. There was a difference in understanding between NHS 24 and the contractor about what they were supposed to deliver.
I apologise for interrupting. Should that not have been sorted out before? If you're going to build a house, you'd kind of come to an agreement about where the bricks went before you started building. So should that not have been sorted out before any money was paid over?
Yes, it should. Absolutely. And I think what happened was some of the stuff that was in the original tender documentation about performance standards had then not been transferred into the contract documentation is what they discovered. But this only came to light when they were trying to implement it in 2013. And the NHS 24 were saying this isn't working like we said it was supposed to. And Capgemini are saying, well, actually, it's working like it says it's supposed to
but
in the contract.
There were flaws in the documentation. Really, it shouldn't have gone ahead until those flaws were ironed out. So as the accountable officer, he should have said, let's get this straight so that we know exactly how we're going to spend the money before you made a start.
And again, I would agree with that. The problem was they hadn't identified that there were flaws until much later in 2013 when they tried to implement it.
Okay, so at that point, who discovered there were flaws?
Nick, do you have anything on the specifics of that?
The discovery really came because there was a difference of opinion between the contractor and NHS 24. The contractor believed that they had supplied the system that they tendered for, and NHS 24 felt that there were patient safety requirements that hadn't been met. And at that stage, the differences between the contract that was intended and the contract that finally went out were identified.
Convener, I hope I'm not straying on dangerous ground, but I appreciate that this has been in court. I think it's been at the High Court, am I right? Has any decision been made? Have judges made any ruling as to... I mean, it seems that NHS 24 are left with brokerage of over 20 million, costing them about half a million a year in additional costs. Were there any costs found against Capgemini, or did the High Court fall in favour of Capgemini and all the costs were on the NHS, the public purse?
Well, as part of the overall agreement, the legal case was withdrawn by NHS 24.
They wouldn't have withdrawn it if they thought they were going to win it. Or why did they withdraw? I'm sorry, I just haven't followed it in detail.
No, and it is very complicated, Mrs. Cannon. So at paragraph 9, we tried to set out a little bit of what happened there. So they went through a whole series of contractual processes, because obviously in a contract like this, there's kind of escalation procedures that they would go through. And as we say in paragraph 9, in June 2014, NHS 24 served what's called a default notice, which could have led to NHS 24 terminating the contract, but they decided, instead of doing that, they decided to go into mediation and to undertake some diagnostic work and work with the contractors to try and salvage the project. So that was the judgment the board made at the time, to try and build on rather than lose the £37.9 million that had been invested at that point.
So they'd already spent £38 million. So Capgemini, they're still working on the project, am I right? Mm-hmm. But BT have been brought in as well. Is that right?
Yes, both suppliers are part of that.
So I'm just trying to understand going forward, apart from the £21 million loan from the Scottish Government that NHS 24 has been lumbered with, going forward, are we looking at something satisfactory coming out of this project?
Well, I suppose that's the million-dollar question, Mrs. Cannon, that we'll need to keep a very close eye on.
It's a bit more than a million. The convener says quite a few million
indeed,
here. Yeah.
It's a several million question, convener. I think we, when we wrote the Section 22 report, I guess we would have envisaged having this conversation with you with a system that was up and running. And that would have been bad enough, given how much it had cost and the significant overruns and all those things. But that's not where we are. And that's even more problematic and worrying for us that they have spent what they've spent to date. They're running up that £450,000 a month in keeping the current systems going. They have worked hard with the suppliers, and I think our sense is that contractually and in terms of the relationship with the supplier, that's in a better place than it was. But clearly, it was a very big decision, not taken lightly, to effectively pull the plug on the system once it had gone live in October. For all the right reasons, I have to say, if there were concerns about patient safety, you would expect NHS 24 to make that decision.
A question, after all, they're only 55% over budget compared to 300% over budget for the cap payment. So realistically, they're, you know, in comparison, it's not too bad, but still a very serious issue within the NHS. Do you have a crumb of comfort going forward that flaws in documentation and arrangements between Capgemini, BT and NHS 24, can you give the committee a crumb of comfort that this will be solved in the months going forward?
So I don't think we're in a position to do that today, Mrs. Scanlon. I think what I can say is that the NHS 24 are taking it really very seriously. They've responded, indeed, and they've responded as absolutely you would expect. The Chief Exec has asked for a detailed review to be undertaken, which should be reporting, and Nick, as the auditor, will get sight of that report very soon, we hope. So we should have a better understanding of what happened at Go Live. And then, as I say, we'll be looking very carefully for the detailed implementation plan when that comes through, for when they want to re-implement it in 2016. Okay. But given the history of the project, I think it would be a brave man or woman that wants to give any assurance on how this is all going to end up.
Richard Simpson.
Yes, you've answered one of my questions. It's 0.45 million per month. So when it was abandoned in October, those costs started again, and they will run until the system comes in, and may even run a bit beyond that, possibly. But I mean, so we're not going to get this till the spring. That's going to be another 4, 5, 6 months. So it's going to be another 3 million, 4 million of brokerage they'll require, Mr. Bennett.
My understanding is that the system won't go live before the end of June 2016.
Right. I mean, what I find astonishing is, having been involved in dealing with IT projects, but not at this scale, I'm very glad to say, you know, there were two things that we did. One was we, in trying to develop our software system, we used an iterative process. In other words, as you went along, you started with a basic goal, which you agreed with the contractor, and you then actually began to develop it and used your clinicians to test the system as you went along. And that was before you got to beta testing, which is when your final system is being tested, you know, before launch. I just don't understand how we've got to this point in this particular situation. I understand the original problem, that the tender documents and the contract documents didn't match, but I don't understand. So my first question is, you know, in terms of your overall view of ICT, which we've seen, you know, what systems are used which prevent this final thing from happening that's now happened?
So, and nor do we fully understand it, I think, is the first point, Mr. Simpson, to make. And I think the challenge for us is, at the time of writing this report, they had gone through that process of testing. It had been an iterative process, as you describe it. It's clearly been around for a long time, so there's been a lot of work and things done to it. I think one of the things that the board will now be looking at is, why didn't the testing process that they carried out kind of late summer of this year, why didn't it pick up some of the stuff that then became quite clear over a particular weekend of operation once it went live? Now, as you'll know, it's very, very difficult to fully replicate a live environment. You can always really test it once it actually pressed the button. But I think what's been striking about this is that some of the performance issues were so significant that it is surprising that they weren't picked up. I mean, you would expect teething troubles and the odd glitch. To get to a point within a few days of pulling the plug on it altogether. Is so something's clearly gone wrong in that testing process. But as to what that is, we don't really know yet.
I'm really astonished at the fact that in your paragraph 25, you refer to the reviews. A gateway review, an independent review by Ernst & Young, an independent lessons learned by PricewaterhouseCoopers. I don't know who paid for all these, by the way. But, you know, you've got all these reviews, and we're still in a situation whereby we are constantly being faced with these ICT problems. Now, I think, Mr. Bennett, you made the point. This is a small board with a very focused purpose, and I suspect almost no experience in ICT whatsoever. So, you know, this to me lies at the fault of the right at the top, that if contracts of this sort are being signed off, you know, why was the contract not reviewed by the most senior part of the digital section of the government in terms of the gap between the contract and the tender vote? I mean, it's such a fundamental error that it should have been picked up by the digital. Well, we'll ask him next week. But, I mean, you know, you must be very concerned if it happens with one project and we're handing these out to all these nine special boards that we've got. I mean, we're a tiny country. Nine special boards we've got running. And if each of them tries to run an ICT project with this sort of situation, we're going to be faced with this again and again and again.
Okay, just advise colleagues, we need to be careful that we're focusing on the auditor's report and the questions around that. There'll be some policy issues which we can take up with the government representatives and possibly whoever else we wish to do that, so just need to be careful.
Thank you, convener. So a couple of brief things, Dr. Simpson. I think first of all it's worth saying that some of the arrangements we described to you in our last ICT project were in existence when this all kicked off back in 2009. And absolutely, I would agree that relatively small organisations without the experience of doing things at this kind of scale, as Nick said, the thing is costing more than they spend every year. You would absolutely expect a degree of external support and help to be not just offered but required, I think, and that has to be one of the things I'm sure that the government will be looking at.
Okay, thank you.
Nigel Dunn.
I'm wondering if I could just expand that point, please, Mr. McKinlay, because we've already looked at ICT contracts in general. We've asked the government about the arrangements for those, in particular the governance arrangements for that. I think several of us went on record as saying this looked to be very complicated. It's tempting to say when we look at these that it may not be working terribly well. Richard Simpson's already picked up on paragraph 25, where we seem to be running up large bills with consultants of one sort or another to tell us things that are probably pretty obvious because we can see them anyway. On reflection of all of it, of which this is but a small part, is the Scottish Government's ICT structure beginning to look appropriate or inappropriate? Is that because of its complexity? Is it perhaps because we just don't have the skills and we believe that contractors should have the skills and the government shouldn't? What's the audit perspective on all of that now, please?
I think the audit perspective is what we said in the report that was very recent, Mr. Don. I think that remains our view, which is it's the arrangements are still pretty new. And if the arrangements for how IT projects are delivered are to be effective, then we would expect them to be managing things like this. I'm not sure we're in a position yet to say whether that's right or wrong or whether it's working, because they are relatively new. But clearly you would expect the governance of how we do digital things in this country to be managing and avoiding stuff like this happening in future, for sure. The thing that's very frustrating is that this is yet another example of where that hasn't worked.
What fraction of ICT contracts don't work? There is a risk that we focus on the ones that we can see as a failure in some sense. I mean, presumably, there are quite a lot out there that have worked.
It's a good question. I'm not sure I have the answer to it. As auditors, we do tend to professionally sceptical, I think, is how we describe it. And it's clear that when things like this go so badly wrong, that obviously that's in the public interest. But it's a fair question, and I'll take that away and see what we can dig out.
Thank you. I think in fairness to those concerned, it might be nice to know
sure
how many of them have gone well, because I suspect it's really quite a large number. Thank you.
Colin Beattie.
Thank you. I'm looking at paragraph 9 and the decision not to jeopardise the £37.9 million investment already made. Having considerable past experience in quite large IT projects, a classic error is to continue to throw bad money after good. Does it seem the decision by the board at that point was a reasonable one?
It's a great question, Mr. Beattie, and we obviously have the benefit of hindsight now. And as you say, one of the sometimes the best decision boards can make is to not proceed with something and just take the hit. I'll ask Nick to say a little bit more about the circumstances at that time. But genuinely, I think that is a question for the board. They took a judgment based on all the information they had in front of them, and the judgment was that the system could still be made to work. I think in that context, it's worth saying that what NHS 24 are trying to achieve here is a good thing. I don't think anyone's arguing that the Futures programme is ill-conceived as a concept. And so the prize, I guess, they were seeing was significant. It's an important part of not just how NHS 24 operates, but how the system operates. And it's part of the discussion we were having earlier today about managing the pressures in the system. So it's just to not underestimate the scale of that decision at that time to pull the plug on it. But I don't know, Nick might have a bit more detail on that.
Yes, NHS 24 had taken on a future programme director who was quite experienced at the time. And she undertook a full risk assessment as to whether the board should proceed with the system. I think the risk assessment was quite comprehensive, so I wouldn't be critical of that particular decision at the time.
Was the board aware of the potential increases in costs at that point? Was that a decision they took on board?
They had already incurred £37.9 million, so there were additional costs that are included in the £117.4 million, which really represent the full 10-year cost of running that service. So they knew that there would be additional costs to be incurred at that point.
Or that it was going to be £117 million as against £75.8
million? Not at that particular time, no.
So they took the decision going forward without actually knowing how much it was going to cost to go forward?
No, they didn't anticipate at that stage that it would be £117.4 million.
How much did they anticipate it would be?
I haven't got those figures to hand.
It'd be interesting to know. I mean, about the only good thing in this report is that services to patients weren't affected. Looking at paragraph 10, it says in the last sentence there, a review of the contractual obligations is currently ongoing. Then again, paragraph 14, auditor's opinion is that financial implications remain significant and ongoing. So what is the risk going forward? Has there been any clue as to whether this is a financial risk? Is it a performance risk?
Yes and yes, I think, both of those things. Nick has reported and will continue to keep a very close eye on the financial risk, both specifically in relation to the project, but then obviously the knock-on impact that has for the board and its ability to continue to break even at the end of the year. Clearly, the brokerage repayment schedule is an additional pressure that they're going to have to live with and deal with. And of course, we've already said that since we reported, we know that they're going to be incurring additional cost, both in terms of running the existing system and presumably in whatever needs to be done to get the new system up and running. So absolutely a financial risk. The performance risk, I guess, is not so much as you've said, we don't think the performance risk in terms of how the service is currently being delivered. It's managing to keep going as it has done. The performance risk is probably more the one of opportunity cost, is what the Futures programme was designed to deliver isn't being delivered yet. And as Nick has said, we don't expect it to be delivered and operational within the next 6 months. So the longer that goes on, the longer we don't have a system that can help provide a better service.
Look at paragraph 7, the flaws in the contract documentation. Who actually had responsibility for the contract negotiation?
At that time, it was NHS 24.
Did they do it themselves? Did they have any outside lawyers, for example, review the contract details? Because it's not just a question of, apparently, as far as I can see, it's not just a question that bits were missed off in terms of the specifications of, as to what was to be delivered, but there's actual flaws in how the document was put together in terms of, you know, the terms of delivery and all the rest of it.
There were external lawyers that, that were involved by NHS 24, but I think their internal processes weren't comprehensive enough in terms of the procurement. They didn't undertake a complete read-through of all the key documents. The signing off and checking was inadequate on the...
you're talking about NHS 24. They didn't read the documents?
Not a full read-through, so they didn't identify the elements that were missing from the revised contract.
Isn't that a little bit odd, that you don't read the contract? I used to read my contracts.
It is. There should have been a page turn on the various documents to make sure that they were complete and comprehensive, and that didn't happen.
The cost of the contract was just for the record. And so they've not read through a document. But what would the cost be for that document that they'd signed for that they didn't read through?
Well, the total cost of the futures programme is forecast at 117.4 million.
But the person would be the accountable officer.
At the time, obviously, it wasn't that. So at the time of signing the contract, the outline business case was anticipating 75. So it's still a lot of money.
So the accountable officer would have signed the contract. Is that who would have signed it?
Yes.
So accountable officer signed the document where either he and nobody within the organisation has actually read through the entire document.
I think that I'm not saying that the contract wasn't read through it at different stages, but at the time that the contract was signed, there wasn't a page comparison done to make sure that some of the elements that were included in the original outline business case had been properly copied into the final contract document.
Okay, Davy Scott.
So, since that's fascinating, Mr. Bennett, does that mean that those three reviews that you and Mr. Finlay described earlier on, did they find exactly that point that you've just made? Did they look into why that contract was so, did not include those details?
I don't believe that was picked up by those reviews.
By those reviews. So what did those reviews achieve, if anything?
I think they did highlight that there were weaknesses in the overall governance of the project, and there were changes made as a result of that, and more expertise was brought in. I mentioned the new future programme director was brought in as a result of that, so that was a positive development.
Actually, the system's still not up and running, and it's still costing £450,000 a month, so really those, you know, we may have brought on one new person, but it hasn't made any difference to delivering the project, has it?
Currently, that's the case. Yeah.
Can I just be clear about the numbers? I mean, you said that the current estimated cost is 117.4. Is that actually the real number at the moment, as of today? Is that still the real number we're working from?
Well, I think. Sorry, can you go?
Well, that was the forecast cost at the time the Section 22 was drafted. But
just remind me of what date that was.
I don't think I have the exact date, but it was in October, yeah. And it was before we knew they'd pulled the plug on it. So as we said earlier, we would anticipate that number to go up, I guess, because we're not going to have the system for another 6 months or so at best, because that was the forecast on the basis of it going live in October.
Yes. So it's then plus £450,000 per month for October, November, and Mr. Bennett said earlier all the way through to June at the current estimate.
Yeah.
So it's £4 million more, basically.
Yeah.
At least.
Is that right, Nick?
I think that's
broadly.
That's subject to negotiation as well. Okay. I understand that the impact in 2015-16 will be £1.1 million in terms of the financial cost. Okay.
And Mr. Bennett, in terms of auditing it, who's paying that extra £450,000 a month? Is that being paid for by the Scottish Government to NHS 24?
Again, negotiations, I understand, are current between NHS 24 and the Scottish Government about how that will be financed.
Yeah.
It but could no be that there be would be an extension of brokerage.
No, indeed, I'm just clarifying it's public money. It's not being paid for by Capgemini or BT, who are the suppliers.
No.
Why not?
I think we have to wait to find out what the lessons learned and the reasons that it was delayed before we can come to a conclusion.
Is this going
to
end up in court? Something that's so far over budget. I mean, I don't actually understand why it came out of court. What did NHS 24 get for coming out of court? They don't have a system. It's cost 117 million plus. They're no better off.
All great questions. And I don't think we're in a position to answer them today, Mr. Scott. I mean, I think that's exactly... I think the decisions around those kinds of judgments are more appropriately directed to the board. And I think what we, as I say, what we can say is that there is significant risk remaining, both in terms of the finances and the performance of the system. And as Nick said, there will be lots of discussions going on with the suppliers, with the government. We have in Exhibit 2 the brokerage repayment schedule. I would expect that will be part of the discussion about what that looks like in future. They may need to rephase some of that. So I think this is why we need to continue to keep a very close eye, because it's a very fast-moving picture.
I totally accept that. Can I just ask, make one final point? I think it would help us, and it may be your frustration as well, if this report included as clear a line of responsibility as is possible to achieve. Because I find it very hard to work out who's responsible for what. I mean, you very helpfully said earlier on to the convener that the accountable officer is the accountable officer. But then there are all these other people coming in, including what responsibility did the three reviews have that Mr. Don rightly referred to earlier on? Do they just do a review and then go away? You know, they have no responsibility for the terms of that review and what it did. I don't know the answer to any of these questions. But in terms of learning from this, what's the point of three reviews if they don't get us any further forward? So I just wonder if Audit Scotland might want to reflect on that for future reference.
I think that's a very helpful bit of feedback. And I think that, as again, with the benefit of hindsight, the review processes clearly haven't delivered a successful project, and nor does that necessarily mean that there was nothing useful came out of them, as Nick mentioned earlier. So,
take that point. Thank you.
Stuart Mullen.
Thank you, Convener. I'd just like to highlight, you know, one positive point from this, and it is paragraph 13. Colin Beattie touched upon it earlier, and that's that whilst this has been underway, there has been no risk to patient safety. And I think that's a very important point to highlight, certainly for anyone who's reading the official report or watching this online at some point later. But I'd like to kind of touch upon it's paragraph 7 and 10. Paragraph 7, where it highlights the flaws in the contract documentation. Excuse me, and then paragraph 10, with the failings in the both organisations, Capgemini and BT, when they're looking at the particular project. I think this highlights once again that the public sector can get things wrong, but so too can the private sector. And clearly, obviously, we are looking at NHS 24, and that's the responsibility, certainly for this committee. But clearly, that the two private sector organisations have got a role to play in this as well, in terms of particularly when looking at the contract at the very outset. So I think that point has to be raised. So it's not clearly our failings here on many sides. It's not just the NHS 24. On paragraph 17, when you touch upon the external appointment, did this individual come from within the NHS? Or from elsewhere within the public sector, or were they someone from outside of the public sector?
Yes, someone within the NHS.
Right, okay. In terms of their experience of IT projects or of any kind of relevance, are you aware of a direct relevance in order for them to really kind of take this particular project and take the situation forward?
I'm not aware of the specific experience, but she did hold a very senior position within the NHS.
Right. Okay. In terms of IT projects, every organisation undertakes an IT project of scale. There are clearly going to be challenges there for that to go forward and move forward. But certainly, my understanding of of organisations is every organisation is different. It will have its own workings, its own internal workings, its own working culture. And in terms of trying to introduce a new IT system, I understand and appreciate that it can be very difficult to get IT experts who actually have that cultural expertise within the organisation, whether it's this one or whether it's any other, so that they can, when the initial contract or the initial proposals have been set out, that it can actually be married up at the very beginning. Because I know the private sector get IT contracts wrong, and they get the benefit they have is that they can then charge their customers more money to cover overruns. That's a different scenario when it comes to the public sector, as we all know. But in terms of the cultural understanding and expertise, after looking at this report and certainly in previous reports and discussions that we've had in this committee, I just wonder if NHS 24 is too small an organisation to actually undertake a piece of a work of this magnitude on its own. And
we need to get to questions.
No, sure. I don't know if you would have a viewpoint on that, or if is that maybe a policy question that you're not able to answer.
Well, it is. So thank you for giving me that out. But what I would say is, and Nick said it himself, I mean, just looking at the scale of this thing compared to the size of NHS 24, bearing in mind as well that NHS 24 does a very specific thing, and therefore its requirements in this project were very specific. So this is not just a, you know, boilerplate solution that you can roll out and plug in. So again, not at all straightforward. But I come back to the same point that in terms of when any organisation is starting out on this kind of exercise, the capacity, both in terms of numbers of people and skills of people and expertise, has to be part of the decision making process about how you're then going to do it. And so I think there is absolutely an argument. It's not necessarily about size necessarily, but it is about undertaking a more robust risk assessment at the outset to say, does this organisation have all the things that are required to deliver a very big and very complex IT project like this?
Do you think they did?
No, clearly not, I think, is the conclusion you get to in this.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks. Colin Beattie wants to come back, just a brief question.
Thanks, Convener. Mr. Bennett, I just want to come back on this question of the contract, which is obviously at the core of whatever's gone wrong here. You said that it hadn't been read. You talked about a page-turning exercise at the time of signing. These are really two different things. Are you aware whether the board actually read and understood that contract before they signed it off?
I think if I could just outline the issue that actually happened. The procurement strategy that NHS 24 followed was one of an output-based specification, which obviously the key performance measures that relate to that contractor are quite critical to that. Well, it's a specification based on what output is going to be delivered. Okay. So as I say, the performance measures are very important. There were two errors really in the procurement process. When the output-based specification was loaded onto the NHS 24 procurement software, there was the omission of some of the performance measures.
Was that a clerical error?
It was a copying error in terms of uploading onto an IT platform. And that...
Was there no maker-checker system?
There was no check done, no. So that procurement software forms the basis of what tenderers bid for. So they bid on the basis of that. But the issue was further compounded by the fact that there were also omissions in the final contract. Again, some of the performance measures hadn't been copied across to the final contract that was signed by NHS 24 and Capgemini.
I find it quite incredible. Was there nobody responsible for checking this contract, for verifying that it actually was going to say what they wanted it to say?
the accountable officer is ultimately responsible. But as I mentioned before, the problem was that there was no complete read through of the various documents to make sure that the copying and uploading had taken place accurately.
Would that have been the external lawyer responsible for that? Would it have been delegated to them?
It could have been a number of individuals, including NHS 24 staff.
So we don't know who was responsible.
So we're not absolutely clear, Mr. Beattie, but I suppose that's the point we're making, and neither were they, because if someone had been clearly responsible for it, it would have happened. So I think one of the lessons we learned from this, and I think if I'm understanding Nick's point correctly, the read-through bit is should be a kind of final check and balance. So that's not the only thing that went wrong here. That's the thing that compounded a whole bunch of other stuff that happened up to that point. Bearing in mind that this is a big and complex process, and as Nick said, the fact that it's output-based means that this is not a big, long list of tasks that you'll do and I'll do. This is about what we're delivering. And in some ways, that's a good thing because it focuses everyone on what they're trying to deliver. What it does mean is the performance measures and the expectation on all the parties have to be absolutely crystal clear. And that's what hadn't happened, and that's what became very clear when they tried to implement it in 2013.
Can we just make it clear that obviously the auditors are not responsible for the actions that should have been followed through, and we'll have an opportunity to decide how we take that forward and in terms of further evidence on that. Just a very brief question from Richard Simpson. And then
one of the things in their annual report of the NHS 24 was that they were committed to the 25% reduction in senior managers. And I just wonder if your audit demonstrated that the senior managers they got rid of had anything to do with the catastrophe. Well, that's maybe too strong. The problems that we're now facing. I mean, it's all very well to see your cut swathe through senior managers, but if you get rid of the people who are actually responsible for significant programs or bits of finance or whatever, so, you know, did the people they get rid of have any adverse effects upon the NHS?
That's probably a question for NHS 24.
Right. But as far as the audit's concerned, of this and the NHS 24 generally, you didn't find anything that would point to problems arising from this restructuring?
We haven't seen any kind of causal link there, and lots of other organisations are experiencing the same kind of reduction.
Well, that's what worries me.
But no, in terms of the work we've done, we haven't identified any causal link.
Okay, thank you.
Nigel Don, briefly.
A very small point. I mean, we've talked about the read-through and we've talked about an output specification. How many pages would an output specification run to? I mean, surely it's not that many words.
I can't remember the number of pages. It's a large document, though.
But surely the output specification can't be. I mean, I've seen documents that big sitting on the table. I mean, I recognise in contracting terms that happens, but surely the output specification can't run to that. Surely it's one side of a piece of paper, isn't it?
It was an appendix, I believe, in the contract, yes.
Okay, maybe we need to ask to see. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, colleagues. Can we now move to the next Section 22 report that we have on the agenda is the audit of NHS Tayside. Just a little changeover of witnesses. And I understand that we've got a brief opening statement from the Auditor General.
Thank you, yes. So the second report we have in front of you today is NHS Tayside. This is the first time that the committee have seen a Section 22 report on Tayside. And the Auditor General has made this report for a few reasons. In 2014, NHS Tayside received a total of £14.2 million in brokerage in two instalments. It received an initial payment of £8 million. To cover retrospective holiday pay enhancements and some overspends in workforce costs and primary care prescribing. And then the board later required an additional £6.2 million following an accounting adjustment identified by our colleagues as auditors of the board in recognition of the sale of land, which was the formerly Ashlady Hospital in the 14-15 accounts. And this is the third year in succession that the board has required brokerage. The report says that the board's reliance on brokerage stems from overspends and an ongoing difficulty to sell a number of surplus properties, which means it's been unable to generate income from planned sales. The board has agreed with Scottish Government that it will repay the brokerage from the proceeds of the sale of these assets, of these properties, and the board is currently engaging with the Scottish Futures Trust to develop plans for the main sites for disposal in an attempt to try and sell those properties more quickly and reduce the risks associated with planning permission applications. Having said all of that, the timing of the disposals remain uncertain, and the Scottish Government has indicated that it will discuss repayment options with the NHS Tayside should disposal not actually happen as planned. In addition to the brokerage repayments in 15-16, the board is required to find £27 million of efficiency savings in order to break even. And as at 31st of July of this year, the board had yet to identify £11.2 million of those savings. In the first 6 months, the board overspent by just over £5 million. As the board continues to rely on the sale of property to address the issues, there continues to be a risk that it will not break even in this financial year 2015-16. So thank you, Convener. Very happy to take questions on the report.
Can I just raise the first question in connection with the land disposal being included in the accounts? Can I just ask how unusual or usual that would be for any of the boards to include the proposed land sale in their accounts, given that the final sign-off hadn't taken place?
I'll ask Kenny to talk to the detail of it, but it's unusual, and it was the auditors that required the it to be changed. And Kenny can give you more detail on what exactly happened there.
Yes, NHS Tayside had signed an agreement with Miller back in December of 2014, where they agreed in principle to sell the property, depending on a number of conditions, and the main condition on that was achieving successful planning permission. I think the board felt that the conditions of the likelihood of getting planning permission was extremely high, and therefore they felt the risks had therefore the risk of not getting it was very small. However, you know, from an accounting standpoint, we think it's quite right that you shouldn't recognise a disposal until all conditions are met, and such an important condition of planning permission, whilst it could be deemed to be small, we know that these things often take longer to be resolved. And indeed, they have now concluded the transaction on the 23rd of October with planning permission and the whole transaction completing. So, yeah.
Saying at their annual, at their AGM of the board, and would those accounts have been proposed to the board and they would have accepted it on the basis that the transaction had already taken place? Was there any caveats attached to the papers in which they... Because I take it this is something that you've uncovered and not something that was presented to the board.
Yes, that's correct.
Yeah, so there's a lot of issues that we've had this with other boards. We've had inquiries at the committee in respect of information that's been provided by managers to board members to ensure that they can take decisions on, for example, brokerage. We had in our inquiry at NHS Highland. So is it acceptable for board members to not be made aware of the fact that the disposal hadn't taken place?
I think it's possibly a question for the board why that was the case, but I think it's certainly unhelpful that the board members were not totally aware of the real position where they were and the recognition of that.
So there's an argument to be made here that it's poor governance that board members had been presented to them a set of accounts that includes a disposal that hadn't taken place.
I think it was the wrong judgment reached by the finance team in recognising that at that point of time, rather than any attempt to mislead the board.
I appreciate that issue, but it does have ramifications on other decisions that the board potentially could take. I mean, I take it there's no record. Is there any trail of the board being kept up to date with whether the transaction had taken place or not, and what progress had been made? Because it's quite a significant omission to say, sorry, these accounts include the disposal and make them available for public record, and then for the auditors to come in following that and say, well, actually, this disposal's not taking place.
Yes, I think you're probably best to ask the board that question as why that's happened.
If
if I can briefly come in there,
convener. So I think it's quite important to, because you drew a couple of comparisons there, and I think we would see some important differences from the likes of the NHS Highland case you mentioned earlier. And I think that, and I should also say that adjustments to the accounts after the signed is not in itself an unusual thing. That happens all the time. This is significant because of the scale of it, I think. So there's always a degree of judgment and debate between a finance director and an organisation and the auditors, because they're coming from a position of managing the finances. We're coming from a perspective of accounting standards and other things. So there's always a bit of that happens. And that's why there's a period between the board, in this case, signing their accounts and then the auditor signing that opinion kind of 3-4 months later, because that's what happens in that process. So I don't think this was about necessarily the board being kept in the dark. And you mentioned brokerage, and in fact, the evidence that we have on page 5 of the Section 22 report, for me, demonstrates actually quite a good process in terms of a finance officers keeping a board up to date about the financial position and the potential requirement for brokerage, which happened way back in November 2014, so much, much earlier than, for example.
To be fair, I'm not raising the issue of brokerage on this occasion.
Sure. No.
The main issue is that the board, were they kept aware of the fact that, yes, here's a set of accounts that includes the sale of this the disposal, it includes that, so it's clearly in the balance. In terms of the various balances that are made available to the board members, were they made aware of the fact that this disposal hadn't taken place before the auditor did? That's the question, I think. And I appreciate it's a question that's to be raised with the board directly, but there must be issues about governance if the board members have been not kept aware of the fact that, yes, here is a set of accounts that have been presented, but the caveat is that subject to... Because, again, I think it's standard practice that these disposals are all subject to the money not being in the bank until the developer gains plan permission. That's probably quite a common arrangement, isn't it?
I'm not aware that the board were aware of the fact until we raised it at the audit committee.
Which means then that decisions that the board had taken as when the accounts were presented to them may have been impacted by that. Because if I'm a board member and I'm not made aware of the fact that possibly that land disposal may not take place, or, you know, hasn't taken place, then it has an impact on decisions that the board take, is it not? So that's an issue concerning the governance then, is it not?
Yes, and
that's the comparison I'm raising. Appreciate there's issues about brokerage with NHS Highland, but NHS Highland was primarily about the way in which the board were provided with information to allow them to take the necessary decisions that they had to take. So if I'm a board member, and nobody makes me, a set of accounts that are set before me that make it very clear that, yes, this disposal has already taken place. There's no caveats, and I appreciate what can happen after that, but it is a significant decision that then, and actually I'd be pretty relieved at the board meeting to say, yeah, that looks very good now, because this land that we're expected to be disposed of has actually taken place. Nobody's made me aware of the caveats, but appreciate it's a decision for, yeah, sorry, a discussion that has to take place directly with the board. Mary Scanlon.
My first question is, how do you expect any health board to make £27 million of cuts in 1 year? Paragraph 13. I'll come to the nitty-gritty, but on top of brokerage, £27 million of cuts in NHS Tayside. Is that possible? Well, and who decided that that would all be done in 1 year?
Well, they currently are required to meet the 3% efficiency savings on a year-on-year basis. Last year, NHS Tayside made £22 million of efficiency savings. I think the key point to draw out was that 60% of those efficiency savings came from non-recurring items, and therefore it becomes increasingly hard for the board to keep on making further efficiency savings, and £28 million will be difficult for the board, there's no doubt about that.
My second question, and Fraser, I've definitely been here too long because I have to correct you. It's not the first time the NHS Tayside, I don't know if it was a Section 22, but I remember back in 2001 too, they had a £16.5 million deficit. And in fact, it came to the Audit Committee, and believe it or not, the Chief Executive resigned, something that doesn't happen now. I think a chap called Tim Brett, but that's all history. But really, I wanted to get into the property disposal. I was brought up in Hillside and went to the school, Hillside Primary School, so I'm very familiar with Sunnyside. Now, Sunnyside Hospital has lain derelict for decades. Now, my concern is that there are various property disposals on the accounts in Tayside, for example, Sunnyside, which is it possible that they appear in the accounts at an inflated value, which makes the accounts look quite good, but when they actually come to be sold, the sum realised is much lower than that shown in the accounts. And does that not create an immediate deficit? I mean, relying on non-recurring savings, we all know that that's bad, but this is a huge amount of land and property, and surely if it was put on the accounts at a certain time in recent decades, the state that it's in now and the property market, it cannot possibly be worth that. So is there not an inherent problem going back two decades to 2001-2002, etc.? Is there not a problem there about overpriced properties on their accounts?
Every year, a full valuation is done by valuers on the properties right across NHS Tayside, and we review that valuation. And the
time.
Sorry?
It's regularly changed to upgrade the state of dereliction, etc.
That's right. So okay. The valuations held in the accounts will reflect the state of the property it's in, and the original cost as well, and exactly what they think they might realise from it. So I do believe that the property values carried in the accounts are appropriate.
So if I can just ask for the Ashloody example, I appreciate it went through in April and wasn't included in these accounts, but was the amount that it was disposed for pretty well equal to what it was on your account?
The Ashloody profit was £4 million on a final disposal proceeds of £5 million. So the net book value was just over £1 million, so there was a profit made on the Ashloody sale.
Right. And you would expect the same from Sunnyside. I believe it's finally on the market for sale after many decades.
Yes, it went on the market in August of this year.
Yes.
And I believe that you would anticipate that you would hope that you'd realise at least the carrying value. But of course, it will clearly depend on by a property by property basis. I think that's one of the challenges the board is facing, is trying to realise the surplus estate they have in a difficult market.
Right. And I just have one other question on Tayside, because I come from that area, I get little anecdotes. But I understand that there is quite an inflated team of directors in NHS Tayside. I just wonder if you looked at the management team of executives, directors, senior managers, is that higher than in other board areas? Are they paid a greater amount than in other board areas? And have they been given superior performance-related pay that is any different to other health board areas? Is that something that you looked at in your audit?
It isn't something we specifically looked at. I haven't done a benchmark to see how that compares to other boards, so I haven't done that. No, sorry.
But you might look at that in future in NHS Tayside.
We can certainly take that on board and look at that going forward.
Thank you.
Come on, Beattie.
Thank you, Mayor. I'm just looking at some of the issues here. I see that there's mention made of changes to how the public pension schemes are valued. And if I'm not incorrect, the additional costs are £5.5 million on the pension?
That's correct.
Is that the deficit?
That is effectively the increase of the cost that they'll be paying going forward. That's similar to all other boards, just as a result of the recent revaluation of the national pension scheme.
Okay. Obviously, that combined with national insurance charges is quite challenging. On paragraph 24, there's mention here that NHS Tayside recognises that traditional approaches to producing savings are declining. What are the implications of that? Does that mean the soft options are finished and now it's going to get a bit tougher? And
yes, I think that's right. I think, as we heard earlier, the challenges facing the NHS as a whole are right across Scotland. But I think that we say that I think you do need to look at the longer term strategic be more strategic and look at more longer term plan to make savings that will be sustained for the long term. So I think that you're right. The low hanging fruit is being picked.
And I'm assuming in paragraph 27 that the overspend of 4.549 million in the first 4 months, does that include the staff payments?
It does, yes. The additional staff payments from the, so which respect to the? The EDL. The EDL, yes. That was accrued at the end of last year. So that's all been taken care of in the 14-15 accounts. And therefore, okay. There's no impact, should have no impact on the 15-16.
So the 4.5 million is separate from that?
Yes.
Not part of the additional staff costs that were accrued for EDL?
Yeah.
Okay. Obviously, they're in quite a difficult position here. Do you think that given the sheer size of the deficit they've got to cover, that it's going to be practical ongoing? I mean, I realise that, you know, whether they sell Ashludy or not, that's a one-off, non-recurring asset sale.
I think that they certainly have challenges in facing them going forward. They need to move away from the reliance on non-recurring items and the dependence on disposals of surplus properties. I know the board's looking at this and coming out of a detailed plan how they might address it, but it's certainly going to be challenging for them.
If I may, convener, just very briefly, in a sense, I think what's, as well as the specifics of Tayside, this is an interesting report because it is a microcosm of the discussion we had earlier about the overview report. I think you see all the pressures in one board, and as Mr. Beattie said, that it does look very difficult for them to break even this year, for sure.
Mr. Simpson?
I've two questions, really. One is the sale that was put on the accounts and then taken off, or discovered it wasn't, was that declared as part of their efficiency savings for that year?
I think it would have been declared as one of the non-recurring
savings. That's what
savings.
I mean.
Yes,
so it's already been included, just in the accounts, but included in the report that we received on efficiency savings.
Yes.
And that's a fairly significant amount. So presumably it won't appear again as an efficiency saving this year, although the sale has gone through this year.
Yes.
Right. Well, I hope someone's taking a note of that and we don't get it. The other thing is the EDLs that we referred to.
Yeah.
The enhanced payments for work during leave, which is a very interesting one. I mean, it's 4.something million, the total amount involved, and it goes back over some 4 or 5 years, and it was raised by staff as being inadequate. Mr. McKinlay, are you comfortable, or Ms. Gardner, are you comfortable that this is a one board event? Are we fairly certain that it's not occurring in other boards?
As you'd expect, Dr. Simpson, that's exactly the question I asked when I received the auditor's annual report. We have done checks with all of the auditors I appoint to NHS boards, and we're confident it's simply this board an error had taken place in the treatment historically.
That's the one piece of good news we've probably had today. Can I ask also about one of the things that occurred? I mean, I've only just joined the Public Audit Committee, but one of the elements that was coming up in finance, looking at future finances in the Health Committee on Health Service, was ensuring that equality of pay was actually undertaken. And I think you qualified previous accounts in previous years on that issue. I don't see anything in this report referring to equal pay issues. The amounts previously couldn't be quantified going forward as to what that would cost. Is that gone now completely? Equality, equal pay has been dealt with and isn't an issue for Tayside that hasn't been addressed?
I think it's the case that there is in just about every health board's accounts a provision for liabilities relating to equal pay. The situation in the NHS is now very different from that in local government. We're in the position where at the end of 2014-15 it was possible to quantify the liabilities for the first time, and the accounting treatment has moved from being an unquantified contingent liability to being a quantified provision, and the amounts involved are coming down quite markedly. That's why I've not drawn attention to them either in the NHS NHS 2015 report that you were taking evidence on earlier, or on the three Section 22 reports that you're looking at just now.
Good. Well, that's very helpful. Thank you. That's it.
Okay. I don't have any further questions from colleagues on that particular report. Can I now move on to the 2014-15 audit of NHS Highland? Just allow for a changeover of witnesses. Just for the record, just to clarify, we now have Stephen Boyle, who's the Assistant Director of Audit Scotland, who's joined the Auditor General and the Assistant Auditor General. I understand that the
Needs no introduction to you, Convener, this particular board, but for consistency, the committee are obviously very well aware that the audit report that Stephen did last year, 2013-14, highlighted weaknesses in financial management that were a major factor in the board requiring brokerage of £2.5 million from the Scottish Government to break even. And as you know, the need for that brokerage was mainly due to an overspend on operating costs at Raigmore Hospital. And the auditor and subsequently the committee in its inquiry identified significant concerns about the governance in the board and the decision making around the decision to go for brokerage. The Auditor General decided to bring a Section 22 back to you this year as an update. Since we did the work and since you had your inquiry, NHS Highland have developed an in-year financial recovery plan, which detailed how the board expected to address projected shortfalls against its budget and achieve its planned break-even position at the year end. The committee will also be aware that the Scottish Government brought forward £3 million of the National Resource Allocation money, NRAC, in January 2015 to help the board reach a break-even position in 2014-15. And very finally, Convener, based on a review of the work undertaken by the board in 2014, the auditor, Stephen, concluded that NHS Highland has strengthened its financial management arrangements and the scrutiny of financial performance. In 2014-15, NHS Highland achieved its two key financial targets, breaking even against its revenue and capital budgets, and 40% of savings made in year were on a recurring basis. Raigmore did reduce its budget overspend to £6.9 million, but this fell short of the £6 million target, which adds to the continuing pressure that the board experiences this year. So very happy to take questions, Convener, on the Section 22 report.
Okay, can we move to questions, Colin Beattie?
Thank you, Convener. Clearly, there's been tremendous improvement here. I mean, from the Auditor General's report, a great deal of work has been done. Obviously, it's still a worry that there's such a high level of non-recurring savings, and that, you know, that comment I think we made at the time that the last report came forward. The big problem does still appear to be Raigmore Hospital, and I know the comment's been made that it's reduced its budget overspend. Are we satisfied that adequate steps are being taken to bring Raigmore Hospital, which contributes such a large portion of the deficit, is there adequate steps being taken to pull that back into financial equilibrium?
As you say, Mr. Beattie, they've responded well to the audit work and to the committee's inquiry in the last 12 months, and an important part of that, we mentioned at paragraph 17 in the report, the three-year recovery plan for Raigmore, which takes us through to 2016-17. I can maybe ask Stephen to give you a little bit of flavour as to what's in that, but it looks to us like it covers all the right things, and certainly when we look at some of the issues that the committee talked to the board about at the time in your inquiry about the way in which clinicians and others in Raigmore were spending money without any real control or reference to their budgets, that's been a particular focus in terms of getting that under control. Stephen, do you want to add to that?
Thanks, Fraser. Certainly we've seen an improvement in the control environment within Raigmore Hospital. And we note at paragraph 22 to the report some of the practical steps they're taking around the director overseeing and taking control of the authorisation of locum doctors and temporary staff, so that oversight is there and that's factored into the financial projections for the hospital, as one example. Having said all that, though, the financial environment for Rakemore remains challenging. And you know, even at period seven, the board's most recent set of in-year financial projections suggests that they are still looking at a potential overspend of £6 million for the year. So you know, in the context of not quite making the savings for the hospital last year and the financial environment still remaining challenging, it remains the case that the hospital, and given its dominance of the overall spend for the board and the bearing that that has, it will remain challenging to continue to deliver on the financial recovery plan.
Can you remind me how much the overall budget for, or at least the overall financial spend in Rigmore is? I'm just wondering what proportion that 6.9 million is.
Thanks. Well, the total exhibit five to the report sets out that the budget for the hospital for the current financial year is 145.8 million.
Okay. Can I refer to the Auditor General's report on NHS 2015, paragraph 64? It says here that NHS Highland reported that its policy is to hold corporate services vacancies open for at least 6 months to allow it to generate non-recurring savings. It almost becomes recurring savings if you do it all the time. I mean, how significant a contributor is that to reducing the deficit? And is it desirable? I mean, if a post's empty for 6 months, do you need that post?
Do we know the proportion of it, Stephen?
I'm sorry, I don't have the proportion of that to hand. In terms of the flipping, as it were, a non-recurring saving into a recurring saving, that has been part of the process that NHS Highland has used over a number of years. Exactly as you suggest, Mr. Beattie, that if a post is vacant for such a long period of time, they will take a judgment as to whether or not that post is actually still required.
It would be interesting to know what sort of proportion of the savings that they're trying to achieve that this contributes. Just one last thing. On paragraph 22 of the report, again, temporary staffing and overtime, it's showing an increase. There seems to be additional controls around it. Does that proportion of 9.859 million seem disproportionate, or is it a reasonable spend?
We can double check that. I think the Auditor General is just very helpfully seeing if we can find a number in the overview report. We don't have it in here, Mr. Beattie, but we can certainly check and come back to you on how that stacks up compared to other boards. Sure.
Thank you.
I think, having been quite critical of NHS Highland, I think it's only right to be fair where they have done some corrective work. I think it's also fair to say that Rigmore overspent its budget in the last 5 years, and it's really only since your section 22 came forward that the overspend's gone down from 9.9 to around 5 million. And I think, as a Highlands MSP, it's also quite annoying that NHS Highland has not received the recommended amount of funding in accordance with the NRAC funding formula from the government for many, many years. So although they got some last year to help them break even, they have been underfunded for many years now. But I just wanted to ask something. NHS Highland and Highland Council, as you will know, were the first organisations in Scotland to have the health and social care integration. So they really are the pioneers here, and all credit to them for making that work. But my concern is that although we've seen NHS Highland addressing their issues, I think the future is looking fairly good. I think they've corrected a lot of things that were wrong in your section 22. But they now rely on Highland Council doing their share, and NHS Highland can do what they want. Well, Highland Council this week are facing £40 million of cuts. Now, I appreciate that this is new to you, but given the NHS budget is protected, and given that council budgets, I don't want to go too much into that, but the point is that the protection for the NHS, and NHS Highland doing everything right in order to, you know, meet your recommendations, they have to take some responsibility, because of this health and social care integration for Highland Council meeting £40 million of cuts. So I'm just asking, going forward, you know, how difficult is this going to be, where we have this kind of integration between the health service and councils? Because I think this may be the first, but is it something that you're looking at going forward, given that so many have followed in the footsteps of Highland?
We are indeed, Mrs. Gardner. In fact, we're publishing our first report on health and social care integration tomorrow, and I think it's due to come to the committee in 2 weeks' time.
Oh, that's timely.
So you'll get plenty of opportunity to go there. I think, right, as well as being the first, of course, the other interesting thing about Highland is that they are now the only board that went for what's known as the lead agency model. All other areas have gone for the integrated joint board model, where they create
children is indeed with the council, and that's worrying.
Indeed,
with 40 million cuts,
and so they've swapped those things over. It's fair to say, without giving too much away in the report we're publishing tomorrow, that the way in which the money is working in all of this is one of the biggest issues that is proving really difficult for NHS boards and councils to bottom out. The report that you'll see coming out tomorrow really is a bit of a position statement, given that it's quite early days in the new integration landscape. So we're really just trying to set out the facts as to what's out there and the shape of them all. But we also identify some issues for the future. And certainly Highland, the council and the board in Highland have had a lot of experience of figuring out how the money works, because the model they developed when it first started, whenever that was, 2-3 years ago, has had to be adapted as the services kind of bottom level out. So, long answer to your question, which is yes, health and social care integration is going to feature heavily in our work programme the next 3 to 5 years.
Can I start? I'm concerned about budgets and how they're set. And I'm looking, as we have done at Exhibit 4, about the position at Regmore Hospital. And I'm just wondering, with the benefit of hindsight, what justification there might ever have been for the budget, given that it's always been overspent, it continues to be overspent by a significant amount. It does rather look as though it costs about £145 million to run Regmore Hospital, and the budget's never actually said as much. Am I being too cynical?
I wouldn't call it cynical. I think it's a perfectly fair observation, Mr. Don. And in fact, you'll see that, and Stephen will keep me right here, that between 11-12 and 12-13, they did actually go through a process of rebasing the budget, which is why it jumps from 130 to 135. So they went through that process then, and it still wasn't enough. And so I would absolutely agree that as part of their longer-term financial planning and thinking about budgets, they will need to think about the budget for Regmore. The challenge there, of course, is if they simply were to up the budget for Regmore by 5 or 6 million, that's 5 or 6 million they need to find from somewhere else. So there's a balance between continuing to try to push down the cost of Regmore, as well as possibly considering a rebasing of the budget.
Which takes me, I think, to the bigger question of how on earth are these budgets set at all? And again, forgive me, I look at the other Exhibit 3, the other side of the page, and I see non-recurring savings of 3 million for every foreseeable year, because they've no idea where they're going to come from. So a figure of 3 million will go in, and the incredibly accurate figures to the left of it are, of course, are just the differences. Now, okay, that's the way numbers come out. Can they do any better? Or is that just the nature of this kind of budgeting, and you're going to work your way through it in every successive year and hope you can make it work?
So as auditors, we would always say they can do it better. That's what we are all about, in a sense. And there is a point at which you have to make some assumptions and you have to put some numbers into the budget. I think it's, as we said earlier on, better longer-term financial planning should help with that, better understanding of the demographics and the pressures and all those things, as well as having some assumptions around what money they're actually going to get, as difficult as that is, has to be the right thing to do. And that's why it's critically important, and this is one of the criticisms in the report from last year, is that in-year financial management and monitoring is so important, so that they are making sure that the savings that they're saying they're going to make in year are actually being delivered.
Does the budget come from a build-up of known costs, or does it come from, this is the slice we've got of the total budget?
Organisations can do it differently, whether it's a priority-based budgeting or activity-based costing, but it's broadly an incremental basis so that the budget and the cost that the organisation is incurring will be inflated for known anticipated costs, known additional activities such as work through the treatment time guarantee and so forth, and that broadly leads to a position that the board is able to strike a budget in advance of the new financial year.
Which makes it very difficult for a board to make any kind of substantial change because it's always deemed to be incremental anyway, but also means that if your historic costs have never been right and you've never actually hit the budget, that it's a marginal change from something which was wrong and continues to be wrong.
It's why we make the recommendation in the earlier report about the need for greater flexibility and the need for better longer term planning, for exactly that reason. If you just continue to add bits on to what you've always done, then the significant change that we think is needed in the system isn't going to come about.
Can I just ask finally, in respect of, sorry, Richard Simpson, brief question.
The paragraph 22, which talks about the temporary staff, I mean, it's a staggering reduction in the Raigmore Hospital locums, 31% in the first 10 months. I'm just wondering what effect that has on terms of the running of the hospital. I mean, if you either needed these locums or you didn't need these locums. I mean, people don't employ locums because it would be fun to employ them or somebody needs a job. It's in order to meet the treatment time guarantee, I would think. So either, you know, Highland are now going to find it difficult to meet the treatment time guarantee, or alternatively, there is a question as to whether the staff numbers are going to be totally safe, which is a really, really difficult question. So, you know, it's all very well for, I've experienced it, of situations where you've got to put an application for a temporary member of staff up to almost the chief executive of the board, and it takes so long to come back down that by that time you're actually, your temporary sickness situation or your maternity leave or whatever has gone. And in the meantime, your staff sickness rate's gone up because you've put so much blooming stress on the rest of your workforce. So, I mean, you know, it's all very well producing this lovely figure, but do you look at these things at all? I mean, the sort of sickness rates, the target effects, the staffing levels and whether they're safe, number of complaints that staff are putting in about being up feeling unsafe.
So the short answer is yes, we do, but not necessarily specifically as part of this piece of work, because the thing that we're focusing on in this piece of work has been around the kind of financial management issues. But you're absolutely right that one needs to be careful that the reduction in the use of locums is not in itself necessarily a good thing. Having said that, it was very clearly identified last time round that the use of locums in Raigmore was one of the significant cost pressures. So tightening controls in the hospital was a good thing to do, we think. And absolutely we would expect the board and the hospital to be assuring themselves that that wasn't having any knock-on impact. When you look at the exhibit in the overview report, there's no doubt that Highland are experiencing pressures on some of the targets. Whether we can draw a direct link between the two things is a different question, Dr. Simpson, just now.
Well, we may see it in the future years. Sure. What really concerns me is this focus on finance, which I know is absolutely, you know, is critical. But if you look back to the mid-staffs report, that's where it all started. And they said, oh, well, we're going to meet our financial targets. They cut the staffing. They made them unsafe. You know, so I would just ask that you look at the staff complaints within the system, and somebody should be drilling down, either HIS or yourself, be looking at that, because we may put Highland under such pressure that we create a mid-staffs type situation.
Very briefly to that, because I absolutely share that concern, Dr. Simpson. It has to be a risk given the pressures we know there are across the health system just now. In the report that I produced on management of waiting times back in 2012 on the back of the problems in NHS Lothian, one of the broader findings we made was that some boards were focusing on financial performance and service quality performance, as though they were different things. And one of our recommendations was that boards should have information that pulls that together for them in a dashboard or some other way so they can see the interaction between financial performance and what's happening to patients. You can't divorce one from the other. They're two sides of the same coin.
that is now happening as a result of your recommendation?
I think it's happening to different degrees in different parts of Scotland. If you were to read the annual audit reports produced by the auditors I appoint to the 14 health boards, you would see they give that overview of not just financial performance, but the other key targets and so on that boards are working to. And part of our review process in deciding what to bring to this committee's attention is to look for disturbing symptoms in those patterns.
Just ask finally, in respect to the vacancy rate, rates, which was an issue come up in the original report, it was quite a substantial exchange when we took evidence on that, as being an issue relating to staff morale and sickness levels as well. Are the vacancy rates still at the same rates as they were previously?
Stephen, can you?
I don't think I've got information to hand, yeah. Convener, sorry.
That's perhaps information that can be provided, because I think that issue had an impact in, because we know that, you know, sickness level, I think actually vacancies and vacancy rates and sickness levels, which was highlighted in the report, would be helpful in terms of providing a before and after in terms of what the position is now.
I remember the conversation, well, convener, and as you say, it was the discussion around keeping vacancies open, and whether that was having any knock-on impact on morale and absence and those kinds, yeah, of things. So we can see what we can dig out on that. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, thank you for your evidence. Can I just allow a couple of moments, just allow the witnesses to leave the table and move to agenda item number 4, which is a response from the Scottish Government on the AGS report entitled Accident and Emergency Performance Update. I wonder if members have any comments on the correspondence that we've received. Understand Colm Beattie's, yeah.
Yeah, I think correspondence from Paul Gray is quite interesting. You know, we're beating ourselves up over not meeting our targets, and yet what we are achieving is better than in the other nations of the UK, and it's better than in some other countries overseas. And I like the bit here where it's highlighted that the report on waiting times in Canada, time to close the gap, it singles out Scotland's performance as a benchmark to which Canada should aspire. And I think that's really quite commendable. Doesn't mean to say we shouldn't be striving for our targets, of course. The targets are there for good reason, good purpose. But it is encouraging to know that we're leading the pack, so to speak.
Mary Scanlon, Richard Simpson.
Well, I take a slightly different tack, because I found that I got halfway through Paul Gray's response, and I know what the state of affairs are in Germany, the Netherlands, Australia, New Zealand, Canada, England, and, you know, I had to read further down until I came to Scotland. And quite honestly, I'm not that interested in accident and emergency times in Australia. I'm really more interested in what they are in Scotland. And, you know, there's no point in setting a target, saying we can't reach that target, but hey, we can't reach it, but we're still better than they are in Australia. I don't think that's acceptable for a Director General. And for that reason, I would just like to finish my comments with the briefing paper on accident and emergency, paragraph 22. The number of people waiting longer than 12 hours in A&E has increased by 55%. And it increased by 292% in the last year. And the number of patients waiting more than 8 hours in the same period went up from 8,700 to 14,000. So I'm sorry, convener, but I don't find it acceptable. We're a Scottish National Health Service. We've got Scottish targets in a Scottish government, in a Scottish Parliament, with the Scottish Public Audit Committee. You know, we are here to audit what happens in Scotland, and when you get a response telling you about Germany, the Netherlands, New Zealand and Australia, it's actually irrelevant. It's not our job. So I would just like to say to Mr. Gray, can he please focus on Scotland? Because we're not responsible for the health service in New Zealand, and I'd like to hear more about what he's doing to address problems in Scotland rather than the other side of the world.
Richard Simpson.
There are 9 targets. 2 have been met, as we've just heard from the Auditor General. 7 have not, and they're all deteriorating. And it's the trend that actually is interesting rather than the actual figure. So, you know, that's a real worry. But there is a difference between the accident and emergency target and the other targets. The other targets, this target we're told is evidence-based. In other words, the consequences of not meeting a four-hour target for the patient mean poorer outcomes. That's what we're told. The other targets are targets which are nice, but they're not clinical. They don't have the degree of clinical relevance. They have concerns about patient rights, the 12-hour target, which we're not meeting, despite being a legal guarantee, and heaven knows I've said that often enough, is quite different to this target. But, convener, the trouble with setting targets is that you get conscious or unconscious gaming. We saw that with the waiting times issue, which the Auditor General again has just referred to. We now know that there are 13 units in Scotland in our acute hospitals which are not governed by the accident and emergency waiting times. These are variously called clinical decision units, acute assessment units, immediate assessment units. I can't remember the name of the one in the Queen Elizabeth, which is where this all came to light. Mm-hmm. But these are not governed by the current waiting times. And what I cannot answer, and I'm not saying that it's happening, but is there actually gaming going on in which referrals are being made to these non-governed units in order to try to meet what are proving to be very difficult targets, even if they are targets which are no longer 98%, which were, are being met at one time, but now 95%, these interim targets are not being met in certain specific areas, mainly in the west of Scotland, mainly in Glasgow. So I think this report is unsatisfactory. I think we need to go back to Mr. Gray and say the announcement that was made by the Cabinet Secretary about looking at these 13 units needs to be brought forward very rapidly so that we understand the true position, and we then have a rational discussion either in this committee or in the Health Committee or indeed in Parliament about the whole business of targets. Mary Scanlon and I are leaving, so we don't have an axe to grind in this respect. And I have said, and my party is saying, we really need to look at this target issue because it isn't just not meeting targets. It's causing exactly the stress of not shifting things into preventive care and community care. Mental health and general practice are suffering as a result. The health service is being deteriorated by targets which no longer actually have a purpose of making the health service better and patient outcomes better.
Tavish Scott, can we just clarify that we actually asked Mr. Gray to provide comparisons across in various
yes,
ways?
I mean,
just to clarify that the reason why he's included this here is that we asked for some benchmarking across the various parts of the... So we need to be careful when... Just to clarify that, we're not here to defend Mr. Gray, but we are here to clarify what information that we asked for. So we did ask for information. Tavish Scott?
Yeah, I just wanted to support Richard Simpson's point about a proper assessment of targets. I'd hope maybe Audit Scotland could maybe assist us in that too. It's probably for a future committee in a future session. But all I hear at a local level in my part of the world is the pressure that this puts on clinicians and staff. I think there does need to be a proper, rational, non-political discussion about the most appropriate ones. I think it's also the other point I was just going to make is it wasn't that long ago that Alec Neil, the then Health Secretary, turned up with this committee to tell us why they were taking the target down from the previous level down to 95. So this is all a relative discussion about a target that's now lower than the original one that was set.
Okay. Just 2 points. One is actually what you addressed yourself there, which is that we actually asked Paul Gray for these comparative figures, both with the other nations in the UK and overseas, where he had them. The second point that I was going to raise is in connection with targets. And it's interesting to note that since 2007, and in 2007 there was 200 reportable targets in the NHS, and that's been taken back to 20. But I agree there should maybe be a discussion as to the appropriateness of these 20. Are we actually getting information that's going to be able to allow us to drive the National Health Service forward in the future? Is it going to give us the vision that we need to be able to allocate resources, which are obviously what's coming down the road to us is changing all the time, and we need to be flexible on that. Are the targets we're looking at going to give us the indicators that we need to enable us to be flexible and to enable us to adapt? And I think that is a valid question that we need to talk about.
Okay, so colleagues, what we have here is the response from the Scottish Government. So we have a number of different options in terms of how we take it forward. So the first one could be that we note the correspondence, which I don't think is the direction of travel from the committee, maybe taking on board the points that have been made by various colleagues. We could respond to the government with some of those points being highlighted, both in respect to the targets and in respect to the point that Colin Beattie's just made. Is that helpful? Okay, is that agreed, colleagues?
Richard Simpson's point about we can get the information about the ones that aren't included in
The 15 centres that are not included. I think it'd be helpful. I think also be helpful in terms of for a legacy for the committee's work and the Auditor General's future work is to look at how that information could be brought forward at some point in the future. Okay, thank you, colleagues. And as previously agreed, can we move to agenda item number 5, and that's the agreement to move into private session. Okay.